Little over a year ago, I was applying to Oxford. At the time, it seemed so far out of reach. I remember the feelings of shame when daring to tell people that I wanted to apply. "You're just a token. You won't fit in at Oxford," scoffed my driving instructor. "Don't you think those grades are unattainable?" sneered my UCAS referee. Even my best friend's parents called my mom, demanding that she discourage me from going to interview because apparently people like us only go to polytechnics. Let's face it, a Black state-schooled working-class student from the North was never going to get a place at Oxford. And yet here I am. Everything changed for me on the 29th of February 2020. The ACS offer holiday connected me to a dynamic network of high-achieving Black women and women, and it inspired me to reject the negative labels I faced in favor of excelling academically. But most importantly, it elevated my self-esteem, allowed me to pursue my dream of studying a law degree at Oxford with a newfound confidence. That is what I want to do as your president. I want to connect our members, I want to inspire members, but most of all, I want to elevate our members. Now, while I was thinking over what I should include as part of my manifesto, two things struck me. Firstly, the lack of Afro-Caribbean representation in the workplace. Now, Black people held just 1.5% of the 3.7 million leadership positions across the UK's public and private sectors in 2019. 1.5%. Secondly, the lack of representation within Oxford. Of the 3,280 students admitted in the 2019 intake, around 3% of us were Black. 3%. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, those statistics look like injustice. As a voice for Black students within one of the best universities in the world, I feel that the Oxford ACS has a duty to address this. In addition to the great events I have planned, I have two flagship schemes that will define my term as president: ACS Connect and ACS Inspire. ACS Connect will serve as the key driver of dialogue between current ACS members and ACS alumni. This is really important if we want to play our part in tackling the lack of representation within the working world. For many of us, especially for those of us who come from a state-schooled and working-class background, it can be really difficult to break into the professional market. This isn't because we're not able, but it's because we don't have access to advice from people who have succeeded in industry. With this scheme, members will be provided with a unique and specialized forum to discuss their career ambitions and build meaningful relationships with alumni who have excelled in their field. ACS Inspire will be the principal addition to the access schemes already championed by the ACS, such as our annual AAC conference. As a student who applied to university college thinking that it was the University of Oxford, and who almost deleted his interview invitation thinking that Mansfield College was a spammy post-16 center, this initiative is really close to my heart. My school wasn't able to offer us any support with my Oxford application, and I had to fend for myself. I want to lead the ACES in helping with closing this gap by reaching out to underrepresented regions of the UK, by forming relationships with bright students from underperforming schools, and by inspiring the next generation of African and Caribbean Oxford undergraduates. But now to the events. Now, as I said in my manifesto, it's not everyday Cambridge. I want to host more events with Afro-Caribbean societies to celebrate our shared culture. By bringing back Oxford discussions, I want to hear about the issues that matter the most to you, be it jollof wars or the plantain versus plantain debate. The ACS ball and the ACS dinner will be two other events I'm looking forward to bringing back. Regarding welfare, I want to create the Office of Women's Representative, who will lead events facilitating the discussion of the experiences of Black women within Oxford. I also want to support members' collegiate experience by introducing college ambassadors to tackle any issues our members may face. The ACS is more than a society. It's given me a home away from home. I hope to continue this amazing legacy by serving as your president. So as part of the election campaign, Sean has made it that I do a bunch of what he calls presidential challenges. Really bad to be myself out like this. You get to see a day in the life, a few of the things I like to do. And so, yeah, I hope you enjoy the videos. The first one is going to be me, my day in the life. I wake up at 7:30, do my hair, take a shower and cream my legs because honestly, it's just embarrassing. I then get dressed, brush my teeth, and then sit down to do some work, read my emails, do some admin, and, you know, timetabling, all of that, and preparing for my tutorial. Today we're learning about the Roman law of contracts, and yeah, it wasn't fun. If I'm honest with you, my shoe was amazing. But yeah, 12, I went to get some lunch and go for a walk. So I went to the alternative tuck shop to get my favorite chicken tikka panini. Can't lie, it makes my breath stink, but you know what, it bangs, so I don't care. So I went to see Amjad, and then I went to do some work in Christchurch Meadows for a while. And then I thought I'd come back, do some work at home. But what happened? I fell asleep. After my nap, I went to buy food and cooked it while I had my meeting with Amjad and Josh. I spent my evening buying shoes and watching Netflix. And yeah, rinse and repeat, and I'll be back tomorrow. Bro, that day was long. That's a day in my life. I decided to wake up on time. Anyway, so the next video is going to come from a good friend of mine, Mr. President, the one, the only Doug, from UNIF. He's got a few words to say about me as president. Please, I beg, ignore my hair, because honestly, yeah, it's just not happening for me.
For sure, I'm running for ACS president, and I'm with Doug, the UNIF JCL president, and he's got a few things to say about my presidency.
So I completely endorse Josh for the role of ACS president. Absolutely, it's the right 100%.
Job. Yeah, so that's Doug, UNIF JCL president, endorsing me for presidency. Thanks, guys.
So the next video comes from Auntie. It's not my aunt, she's my friend's mom. She had a few words of support to say about me running for ACS president.
Josh is my son's friend, and I am endorsing him for the ACS presidency.
Now, the last video is a video of my favorite food. As you can probably imagine, being in Oxford, this was really hard to find. You know, I think this one takes the win. Yeah.
McCoy's is the best food place in Oxford. It's run by Waddles, the CEO of Heavy Breathing and Coughing on Your Food. Whether it's dropping hair on your chips or sneezing in your kebab, McCoy's staff always do that bit extra to keep you from your essay and keep you on the toilet. Nah, I can't lie, you're better off getting some pot noodles.
So yeah, that's it from me. I hope you enjoyed the videos. But now it's time to hand over back to the Hustings. Just one thing before I go, keep remembering to be a dreamer and for a dreamer.
Lit. Well done, Josh. Okay, so then now we'll go to Aaron for his speech.
Thanks, Sean. So, hey guys. Although most of you may have seen my manifesto on the ACS Facebook page, and of course you've just seen that 5-minute video of me getting violated, I'd like to introduce myself so I can connect with you all a bit more. So, my name is Aaron. I study classics at St. John's College, and I'm Ugandan and proud. If I'm being honest, this all feels so surreal. The fact it was only 2 years ago when I was hooked on videos of the ACS on YouTube, and now I'm speaking before all of you today in the hope of becoming your ACS president for the upcoming academic year. I remember when I first discovered the existence of Oxford ACS. I was in year 11, and I was aspiring to make an Oxbridge application. However, like most, I had my doubts about whether there would be people at this institution that I could connect with. And naturally, I started questioning whether this university was really for me. But when my friend showed me one of the ACS YouTube videos, I believe it was the LMH College tag with V and Josh, my attitude towards the application process completely shifted for the better. After seeing that there were people like me at Oxford, I was inspired to continue to go the extra mile with my academics and to put in those late nights so I could one day be a part of this very society. Then, in my final year at school, I invited the ACS committee of 2019 to 2020 to my school to run subject-specific workshops and to give talks to Black students with similar aspirations. This was a huge success. Genuinely, the kids in my school didn't stop talking about it for weeks. But also, it allowed me to witness firsthand passionate members of the society inspiring prospective students and showing them that there was a family waiting for them when they arrive. Fast forward to this year, I've had the opportunity to interact with great people through the ACS, both within my year and outside my year. Also, being on the committee as Junior Access Officer has allowed me to work alongside dedicated people to benefit the society we all love. I just want to take this time to mention a few instances that have particularly stood out to me in this regard. When the Oxmas event at the Freud Bar had to suddenly be cancelled due to the introduction of the government's COVID winter plan, Cara, Ibti and Danielle took it into their own hands to produce goodie bags for the freshers. This was no easy feat. They had to go out and buy all the materials required, and they spent hours customizing these goodie bags, but they endured all of this for the benefit of us. On a more personal note, another instance that stood out for me was when Sean, our president, emailed St. John's on my behalf, who had not allowed me to return to my accommodation despite the unfortunate circumstances occurring within my household, showing that the society is willing to go the extra mile. How I feel about the society is simply more than words on a manifesto. It's a tangible thing that I've seen and experienced, and I'm determined to continue this tradition of passion and genuine care as your president. My vision for the year is the empowerment and unification of the society in all its forms, prospective, present, and past. And I have some events and initiatives lined up for the next year to support this very vision. To benefit the prospective applicants, I plan to take ACS's current visions program, which is aimed at equipping pupils from years 9 to 11 with the tools necessary to achieve their goals, up north to Manchester. This is necessary because the majority of ACS's access work is conducted within London, which naturally has had the effect of making Oxford ACS a very London-centric society. But we need to accommodate all African and Caribbean students. In doing this, I plan to make this a joint project with Manchester ACS, like our committee of 2019-2020, to increase collaboration with ACSs other than Cambridge. To benefit our current members, I hope to bring back the amazing in-person events the society has had on offer in the past. Meet and Eat, ACS Club Nights, Ox Chat, and University Challenge, to name a few. I also plan to introduce some new things. I want to slightly expand our large committee with the addition of a freshers rep and a sports rep. The freshers rep will be the first point of call for freshers throughout the year, but they will also be responsible for creating the freshers pack. The sports rep will help ACS members with sport-related issues at the university, but also organizing the Oxford versus Cambridge ACS Sports Day, which will allow us to increase our collaboration with Cambridge and prove that we can beat them in events other than University Challenge. For both our current members and past members, I'd like to introduce the ACS Family Reunion event, which will be a ball designed to keep our alumni connected with the society. This will be beneficial because it will allow us to keep our ACS family strong, but also it will present networking opportunities for both parties. And next year, I hope to enter the ACS for BAME Society of the Year Awards to prove that we are the best ACS around. Several things are in the works, trust me. And I can assure you all that if you place your faith in me, I'll take the society to greater heights whilst preserving its best attributes. Thank you very much.
Come, let's go. So obviously I've started off like a serious candidate, bubble machine in the corner, because we stay bubbling. Don't let that one go over your head. No heading off the place of football. Look at John's looking beautiful in the background there. And obviously we have to stop off at up block ends. It's all love, just trust, all love. I look at you this, struggling to climb the fence, hey. And I even see the consequences of losing at football.
Didn't they? Something!
Hungry as we were, we had to swap one of our supposed favourite foods, but McCoy's. It's called nothing in London, but, you know, food's the same after sport. Now, tuck yard, and we start chefing up. Look at those flavours. Everyone's vibing. Thanks, Watch. Did you guys like that TikTok? Not gonna lie, yeah, that was the first TikTok I ever made. Now that I've had and voiceovers, best believe I know that to act. But anyway, this is the Aaron you've all come to know and love. I wasn't always this way. Secondary school was a dark, dark time. I can't believe I'm showing you guys this, but... Long day. I don't know what was worse, my school uniform or my gym in year 7. Not gonna lie though, bashers are actually character building. And low key, they're the reason why I'm able to stand for you all today. Anyways, let's see what the people who knew me during this time have to say about me. Good afternoon, my name is Daniel Nyango, and today I am very proud to endorse my friend Aaron Aguilar for president of the Oxford Afro-Caribbean Society. I've known him for 8 years, and in that time, I've admired his humility, his commitment and dedication to whatever he puts his mind to. and his 100% authentic, genuine nature. I assure you, if you place your trust and support in Aaron, you'll never regret it.
Aaron is ambitious, pleasant and thoughtful. That's why I think you should vote him as your next ACS president for Oxford University.
You see all the nice things people have to say about me? Okay, I know it may sound like it, but I can assure you guys, no people are held at gunpoint in the creation of this video. But let's see what some other friends have to say about me. Hopefully it's a bit more balanced. I'm in school, Aaron, I've been in season 11. I was co-house captain with him, so I've had first-hand experience of his leadership, and I know he's a committed guy, very responsible, and very responsive. However, before you vote for him at ACS president, you should know that he says plantain, not plantain, which is just wrong. He's allergic to pretty much everything. If there's a dog in the room, he'll run out of the room, and if you put him in water, it's very likely that he'll drown. But I know for a fact that he'll be a fantastic president of the Afro-American Society, not at all. Hello everyone, my name's Tom. I went to school with Aaron for 5 years, and I'm here to tell you he's the perfect man for the job. I think Aaron would be a great candidate for ACS president. He's caring, he's passionate, he's driven, and he's got great leadership qualities. My only criticism of Aaron is that he just thinks he's too good to walk through small spaces, and I've got a perfect example of you there. Other than that, keep him away from long grass, deep water, small handwriting, and then smash it. I used to listen to this in New York. Talking greatest guy, greatest. She looked down bad. Yeah, no, 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 I was looking down bad. This is what happens when you lead to me out without a boo. But if I'm being honest though, I do listen to music like this. Like, a lot of people don't know this about me, but my favourite genre is actually R&B. Like, lots of R&B songs, I love listening to the genre. But another thing you should know about me is I'm always slumped. For me for president, and if you need further convincing, check out what my editors have to say about me.
Everybody, I'm Emmett, president of St. John's College JCR, and I'm endorsing Aaron for president of Oxford ACS. And you should do.
Amazing, amazing. The camera off, even. Oh, okay, cool. I've always like, was that a drop the mic moment, but virtual. Okay, calm. No, honestly, guys. I can say one thing, we've got a competition on our hands. Some difficult decisions are going to be have to made at the virtual ballot box. But cool. So I think I just saw Esther join. So Esther, if you're about and you want to maybe speak. Hello? Yes? No? Because basically now what we're going to do is we're going to go to the part which I said before, which is questions from, like, you know, past presidents. So myself, Chris and Esther, if she wants to hop on and ask a question. Yeah, Esther, basically we're just going to start off with the questions now, and you know, if you want to like hop in, ask a question to the candidates.
Cool, sounds good, thanks. Hi everyone.
Yeah, I should properly introduce. So she was the president before Chris. So yeah, big ACS legend in the building. But cool. So I guess I'll start off the kind of presidential questions then. In a bit of an Oxford manner, basically, just kind of define the Oxford ACS, and what do you actually think the kind of fundamental aims are of the society? So I'll go to Aaron first for that.
So for one thing, I feel like one of the reasons why I think my vision is really powerful is because I feel like my vision represents the values that we already have as a society. I feel like the ACS has aimed since its founding to empower students both within our society and external to our society. We benefit the wider Black community. And so we do this through our access work. So we always do the Visions program. We go to schools and we don't just, what I love about ACS, Oxford ACS, is not just targeted increasing representation into Oxford University itself. It's also aimed at helping young Black people achieve their goals, helping them get into maybe the acting field, maybe getting into journalism. This is what the Oxford ACS is about, but also internally, because we have to face it. There's so many issues that happen within this university, race-related issues, and the Oxford ACS has got everybody's back. I mean, I remember before my time at Oxford University, before I joined the university, I remember seeing instances with JCR Hustings. I don't want to really mention specifics because I don't think that'd be too appropriate, but JCR Hustings and obviously the statue in one of the colleges. And seeing this as somebody who was just about to join the university, this was pretty tough, but watching the ACS mobilize and stand together during this time, sending out statements and all of this stuff really showed me what the society is truly about. I think it is about that empowerment, that mobilization, and ultimately there's a sense of camaraderie that this society has. And I feel like that is the ACS to me. It is a family, we stick together. And as your president, I would like to continue this very vision through unifying us, making sure our alumni stay connected with us, our current society, but also empowering the prospective applicants. And I think that is a very important thing. Expanding access outside of London, this is something that I've wanted to do for a long, long time. And I feel like this is something that we can definitely do next year, keeping all of us unified, but also empowering us at the same time. Thank you.
Cool, and Josh?
For me, I see the ACS, I can sum that up in a simple phrase, the voice of people of African Caribbean descent. Within a university like ours, as I said in my speech, African and Caribbean representation isn't that great. There's not that many of us, and we need a society which we can see confidence, which we can put our confidence in to speak on our behalf. I think this is summed up in my mantra, connect, inspire, and elevate. We need to connect our members to people in their prospective career fields. That's speaking up for them and putting them in a place where they haven't traditionally been represented. We need to inspire the younger generation. They see Oxford as a place that doesn't accept them. I kind of tried to challenge this at the start of the year with the bullying picture, to dispel these stereotypes about Oxford that put so many talented African and Caribbean students off applying Oxford. And then we need to elevate the people in our society. I really noticed this, especially early this year when I, as many of you may know, when I got involved with the tutoring issue. Sean, messaged me as the president of the ACS. He messaged me and offered me his support. And that's what the society is there for, to look after its members and to support us and to speak as our voice. I want to continue this legacy as a president. I want to continue elevating, I want to continue inspiring, I want to continue connecting our members, and I want to do for the society what it's done for me.
Great. Chris, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. I was going to ask, what do you guys think is going to be your biggest challenge if you were president, and then how do you sort of think you'll be able to go around like overcoming that challenge?
I guess we can we'll go to Josh first this one.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge for me, I was thinking about this before I started the Hustings, and I think members of the African and Caribbean community who aren't involved with the ACS, I think that's a big challenge, because the ACS is supposed to speak for people of African and Caribbean descent from all different types of backgrounds. And if people are feeling, for whatever reason, that they can't connect with the ACS, I think that's something that needs to change. And I want to change that. And I think that can only be done through discussion. So, identifying those type of people and, really engaging in conversation as to what they think we can do better, which is why I wanted to introduce the colleges rep, the intercollegiate rep, because some people feel like some colleges, some of them with the statues and things, don't really represent the experiences of African and Caribbean people, and they think that the ACS could do more. And, really understanding why they don't want to be involved with the ACS, I think that's, and changing their perceptions, I think that's the most important thing, and that's the most challenging thing, actually, that will come as a result of my presidency.
Great. That was a great answer. Aaron?
Yeah. Obviously, as we know, with the whole situation of the COVID vaccine rollout, we are, with the events that both me and Josh and I, in our manifestos, we've been trying to include, some in-person events, but obviously this isn't down to us. This is always subject to change because of the situation that we've been placed in. So naturally we have to sort of be adaptable. As you guys know, with the access work that I was hoping to do up north in Manchester, I wanted to make this more in-person because I feel like when you do in-person access work, you can really light a fire within people and really uplift them in a greater sense that you can with online stuff. So that is one of the things that I feel like would be really difficult and something that is really difficult to overcome. However, with that being said, members within our committee and our society have already been going to lengths to make sure that even if in the event that we can't have in-person events and all of this stuff, we will still be able to put on for the members of the wider community and within the community. For instance, Victor, our senior access officer and my senior, he's decided to take visions online. We started filming videos for students from years 9 to 11, targeted at increasing their cultural capital, also, public speaking, all of these different things, and expressing your ideas and, just generally planning. And I feel like these videos are really essential because we can distribute them in any sort of form that we would like to. So this is a really big movement because the fact we've been able to take it online means that in the event that we can't actually host these in-person sessions, we're still good. So yeah, I think that is probably the biggest challenge in my opinion. I feel like it's the adaptability element of that. We have to make sure that we don't, we've got all sort of options covered beforehand.
Wonderful. There was some knackered guy in the chat who said some nonsense. My man's been removed. Quick time. But yeah, we move. But they were really great answers. So well done. Cool. I'm going to maybe just give you a situational question. So something like this has happened. So you and the exec probably make a decision which you think is like neutral, so not necessarily, right or wrong. But once you kind of like talk to your committee members, they're quite actually disappointed and upset by that said decision. So then what do you think the best way is to respond to that situation to your committee members? Aaron.
So firstly, I'd just like to mention this before I go into the instance. Talking about this particular instance, I feel like the ACS is a democracy, and I feel like with all the decisions that I would ever make as a president, I would have definitely consulted my committee beforehand just to make sure everybody is on board with everything that is going on. But in the event that if this did end up happening, I feel like conversation would need to occur between me and the people that I may have upset by my decisions. Of course, as an ACS president, I believe that there will always be people who will criticize you for certain things that you may want to do. And that's natural. That's really, really natural. And I feel like sometimes you do have to make tough decisions, but I feel like you need to acknowledge people's feelings. You really do. This can also take the form of criticism of some of the things that you may have wanted to instill or you have instilled. And I feel like you need to try and take this constructively. Of course, they may be emotionally charged criticisms. People may be very, very angry at you, but I believe the ideal president will look past this emotion and try to take the criticism constructively. But whilst doing this, I think he should also acknowledge how everybody is feeling within the society to make sure that he is taking into account everything he needs to as your ACS president.
Great. Josh?
firstly, I think this question really hints at my leadership style. And yeah, I think the nature of the ACS leadership and the nature of the ACS executive board is that everybody has their departments that they're responsible for. You know, we have welfare, we have access, sponsorship careers, and so forth. And I think what would be important to determine in that situation is who was in the right and who was in the wrong. It's in the sense that if I'm a leader and if I'm leading the ACS, I'm not a dictator. I don't just make decisions without consulting the people who are responsible for making those decisions. I think it's really important as a leader to rest on your team, to be supported and be lifted by your team, because you can't do everything alone. And if I've made a decision without consulting the person who, you know, is responsible for looking after that sort of area, that's wrong of me as a leader. So determining whose area that issue arises under is really important. And say if, for example, say I've overstepped, I and the exec have overstepped our mark, you know, and people are upset, then clearly we're in the wrong and those things need to be changed at once. But at the same time, if I've taken the due and the correct way of, you know, acting and leading and people are upset, my role is as a leader. And if I have the support of my team, then that's just how it has to be. But it's the crucial thing is to make sure I'm doing things in the right way. I'm listening to the voices of the people who are responsible for these things and I'm getting things done in the appropriate manner.
Cool. Sorry, like maybe Chris or Esther. Yeah, Chris.
What is one sort of trait or quality that you've seen in Sean's presidency that you would really like to emulate if you were president? And on the other side of that, what is something that you think he could have arguably done better or something that you would like to change specifically around how he was leading the society? Josh, go first.
One thing that I really, really like, I say this to Sean quite often, is his adaptability. All of us know that this presidency was stolen from him. COVID just came and just went, nope. But honestly, the way he was able to change, to think quickly, and to adapt to the situation that was put before him. Aaron mentioned as well, the last minute decisions that the team made, you know, with the goodie bags. Those are real qualities that I want to emulate, simply because as part of, you know, life these days, we never know what the government's going to do next, what restrictions they're going to impose, what restrictions they're going to loosen. I think it's very important to have the initiatives that you have planned spread over a diverse range of things. That's why I have planned both virtual events and in-person events as well, to keep flexible and keep myself adaptable. In terms of what he what he could have done better, please, Sean, look after me for this afterwards. Yeah, I think it's very difficult to judge because we have the benefit of foresight. But one thing that would have probably been done better is in terms of planning and thinking ahead. Obviously, no one could have expected what happened to happen. But I think now in this position that I'm in, I can foresee that. I can see what has happened before me. And I can think, well, okay, I need to plan. I need to make contingency plans in case what my intentions don't come to pass. So that's one thing I think could have been improved, and that's one thing I'm aiming to do in my future leadership.
Cool, Aaron.
Yeah, well, I'll start with the positive. I think the thing that I think Sean did very, very well, I mean, his number one trait is his charisma. I feel like, you know, with his charisma, he's really, really open. He engaged when I joined, actually. I remember our first conversation, he scouted me out and he made the extra effort to talk to me. And other freshers, both in my college and outside of my college, have also said the same thing. He engages with people in society. He makes that effort, that extra effort to talk to us. And I feel like that is an essential role of a president. You need to be, I think you must be charismatic. You have to be able to, you know, be very social and talk to people. So I think that is probably Sean's best trait. As for a criticism, well, I think being on the committee has sort of allowed me to kind of see what Sean has really done on the inside. And I feel like you've done a lot of great things, but I feel like in certain situations, you can like tend to back down quite a lot. And I feel like as a leader, like if you have a really, really good point that you think like is right, then you should stand your ground. Of course, you need to hear everyone's opinions, because at the end of the day, that's how we reach the best decision, and that's how we reach the best thing for the society. But I feel like in certain situations that I've seen that have happened both within committee, you know, and some stuff that you've done, I feel like you tend to back down quite a bit. So I feel like improving that may make you one of the best presidents I've ever seen, but you've done a really good job, trust me. Really good
job. Great. Didn't realize it was my Hustings, Chris. Thank you for that. But no. That was good. I appreciate the honesty, you guys. Cool. So I guess
Sean, I'm gonna ask a quick question.
Cheers. Big Esther. Of course not.
For once, I'm not gonna make you guys rap because this is what I typically do. But you guys don't know me, so I don't want to embarrass myself. So my question is, of course, as has been said, the ACS is a democracy, but if you could build your ideal team to work around you and to work with you, how would you build them? Or who would be in that team? And that question can be as vague or as specific as you want.
Should I? Yeah, I'll go. Well, I think the main thing that, the main thing that I would look for when picking people to fill in the roles, whether it be senior careers, senior access, would be the fact that they'd have to be as passionate for society as I am. They would have to be able to put in the work, put in all of that, go the extra mile so that we can ensure that everything gets done and that, you know, everybody in society is happy and thriving. Because I feel like one thing is, when you're president, you do not have the sort of time to be sort of micromanaging and, you know, sorting out those very minute details. You want to have faith in your committee, ultimately. Your committee are you're also a kind of mini family within the ACS's family. I think it's a great thing there that you've got going with the committee. So ideally, you want your committee to be able to handle their individual tasks. You know, you don't want to have to be chasing people up. So definitely, in the hustings, when they're doing the hustings, you have to be able to see that they're all very passionate about what they're trying to do. They need to come with ideas, things that they've already thought about. They need to have been thinking about the role. So I'd say that's the number one thing that I'd be looking for as president for people within my committee.
For me, I'd like to say, I'd like people who have a wide range of skill sets. We need diversity of thought and people from different backgrounds who can bring different additions into the society. I'd also agree with what Aaron said about people who are passionate and dedicated about the society. But for that reason, I disagree with him about what he said about Sean, simply because having people on your team who are passionate about the society, they have their roles. And as a leader, knowing when to back down is a sign of great leadership. And those are the type of people I'd want to support me on my team, because they can give me ideas that I may not have thought of. And if their ideas are better than mine, or if they provide an insight where I didn't really recognize that insight, I'd want those type of people on my team to steer me right when I'm wrong. So yeah, people with diversity of thought, people who can bring new ideas from different fields, people who can use those ideas with passion to do what's best for the society and do what's best for its members.
Cool. And I guess, so another question. So one of the first tasks I'm going to do with the president-elect is kind of sit down and talk about our constitution, which is quite long, and it's definitely in need of a reform. So my question is kind of how, because you guys have had time to look at the constitution, are there any areas you think that need reforming? You know, are there any improvements you'd like to make of the constitution? What would you like to add, etc.? So Josh?
So as I mentioned in my manifesto, and I'm quite surprised that this hasn't been done already. A woman's representative to talk about issues facing Black women. It's quite common knowledge that Black women are among the most disadvantaged groups in society on the grounds of gender and the grounds of ethnicity as well. Those conversations need to be had. I've got a few initiatives planned for that. So for example, this can happen both virtually and in person as well, but weekend dinners to discuss, over Zoom, perhaps we can give them a voucher to discuss the issues that are facing them and how these can be tackled, and then feeding that back to the ACS executive board and seeing what initiatives we can put in place to tackle these. Secondly, the college representatives. Now I've been lucky in terms of when I faced the discrimination in the media. I had a great college president who fought my battles. She offered me free legal representation. But not everybody is as lucky as to have that. And some people who face discrimination within college do not have a voice. Yes, the ACS can, you know, do its bit, but it's not omniscient. It's not there to see the nitty-gritty issues that happen within colleges. I think a college representative who's in the college, who knows the college culture, can really analyze and, you know, engage in regular discussion with, you know, college authorities to reach a way forward that promotes the values of the ACS.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like the constitution needs to be edited in certain areas. For one thing I saw is we need to actually add the LGBT aspect of society into the constitution. As we know, the constitution needs to be updated. It's quite a few years old. So, and the LGBT side of our society is something that's a really new addition. So I think in terms of that, we need to add that in. And as president, I would like to stress and keep on going the effort that Nadia's put in to this, the LGBT events that she's hosted and all of that. So I think that's one thing we should do. Also, through reading the constitution, I've noticed that there's certain things within it that are really, really old ACS that haven't really been kept up to date. For instance, with the whole suspension part about, you know, whether you can suspend members, you need to have, apparently it says that everybody needs a membership card. And if you don't bring your membership card into your events, you can't take part in those events. And that's what happens when you're suspended. Your membership card is stripped. However, after speaking to Sean, he's told me that, you know, he didn't get a membership card in his time as a fresher. And he also thinks that, you know, I don't think it's really ever happened. So it's just instances, it's just things like that within the constitution that need to be edited. Like there's stuff that hasn't actually ever happened in the society that is just there. So I feel like it sounds like a good idea. And if it's a good idea, we can definitely include it. But I feel like having stuff within the constitution that actually hasn't really happened within society needs to be taken out. So we need to make sure it's kept up to date. That's what I said.
Cool. Chris, do you have another question? No? Okay. Yeah, I have another kind of like situational question. So like every day as president, as I'm sure Chris and Esther can agree, you get a lot of emails and a lot of DMs on, like, you know, the social medias, etc., asking people want to collaborate on this, they want your help with this, etc. Everyone wants to basically do something with the ACS. So how do you basically decide what is important and what is not when different people are approaching the society?
So I think I really resonate with this question simply because around mid last year, I was running an access organization called the Opportunity Directory. And this happened all the time, you know, especially with access initiatives, especially in when I was talking about, you know, the corporate firms wanting to have that badge of representation and, you know, be shown as inclusive. Everybody wants the best universities, ACS. I think what's important is to determine between who wants to benefit the society and who wants to benefit themselves. Where I, as a president, would be here for the society. I'm here to serve the society. I'm not here to network with, you know, organizations. I'm here to do what's best for our members. And determining which one is best for the society, I think, is the best way of, you know, determining which ones to respond to first. I think also prioritizing them, because it's not as simple as, oh, let's air these ones, let's reply to these ones. Creating what I used to do when I was leading that organization, I used to categorize emails that I get. So in terms of priority, so I have 1, 2, 3, and 4. The ones that are in the first category can obviously be brought forward, and those are the most important events, the ones that we should be prioritizing. The lesser important ones, of course, you can push them back. It's not necessarily a matter of we keep these ones or we remove those ones. I think you have to be very flexible and to maneuver around them, because the ones which you class as like the least important could end up being the most important. But I think initial decisions need to be based around what is best for the society and what can benefit our members.
Yeah, just to build on from what Josh said, he spoke about, you know, sort of picking the most important events. But I mean, we also have to remember important for whom? Our society. We need to take into account the interests of our society. in producing events. For example, we can take into account our career events. So a lot of people have said that the Oxford ACS is very corporate. I mean, if you look at our first term, we had our Meet the Sponsors event, which, you know, got all our big firms, Clifford Chance, First Bank Nigeria. And, you know, for the people who are very, very career minded in that sense, that was a really beneficial event. However, for some people who want to go into journalism, who want to go into acting, who want to go into sports, anything else, that I don't think they benefited that much from that Meet the Sponsors event. So I feel like diversity is something that is very, very crucial, and it's something that we should push for next year. Obviously, I understand that the first term is a crucial time for corporate applications. You know, spring week internships around the corner. So naturally, in terms of positioning and in terms of importance, that important scale that Josh has just been speaking about, you know, naturally corporate events would be stationed there. So it's all about time proximity. However, that doesn't mean that I mean, in terms of this term, there haven't really necessarily been much events targeted at journalism or, you know, getting some academics in. So I feel like diversity is something that we need to take into account. And we need to take into account the interests of our society's members, because at the end of the day, like, everyone has to eat, everyone has to get their job, the job that they want to do. We want to empower everybody. We don't just want to empower a certain cast of people that may want to pursue law and careers such as that. So definitely I'd say time proximity is one thing that we can judge the importance of events, but also diversity and thinking about what our society truly wants. And we will ask all of you. We will ask all of you what you want, and your ACS will deliver. I can assure you it will deliver.
And just a cheeky plug, week 8 for sponsorship, we have securing a postgrad. Come on. So, you know, we hear the corporate thing there. And I guess, so my final question, unless, you know, Esther or Chris want to ask anything else before going into like the kind of more general questions, is how do you basically handle stress? Because the role can be stressful. So how do you think, so what kind of like, you know, mechanisms do you have for coping with stress?
Yeah, I'll go with this one. Well, coping with stress, I mean, Oxford is a very stressful place, as we know. We've all got massive workloads with all our degrees. So I feel like when you're taking into account, when you're thinking about applying for a position like president, which is so intensive, you need to think about how you can mitigate stress. So I've actually been thinking about this. How do I mitigate stress? And for one thing, I've got my friends to help me. So whenever I've finished my work, you know, I need some time to unwind. So just being around friends, I feel like, is a really, really good thing. Doing stuff with friends, that's good. But also enjoying and participating in your hobbies, that is one good thing to mitigate stress. Whether you like playing football, whether it's going on runs, or, I mean, for some people, whether it be gaming, there's so many different hobbies out there that you can get yourself stuck into. And Oxford has a wide range of societies that one can participate in. So I feel like in terms of stress, it would be really, really beneficial for people to be thinking about societies and start thinking about the things that they enjoy. So in the little time that we all have to enjoy ourselves at Oxford University, you make it count and you know, go at it there. And I think that's the best way to handle it.
So yeah, being a law student at Oxford and all the stuff that I've done over the past 2 terms, I feel like I've almost got a master's degree in stress. I feel like the key thing for dealing with stress is really managing your time. There's a thing on TikTok, which I think is a little bit harsh, but it has some truth to it. It says, are you really stressed or do you just leave your work to the last minute? Last time, especially when I was really getting used to the workload, at first I really struggled. It was quite difficult, but then I noticed as I started to learn how to manage my time effectively, my stress decreased massively. You can see in the events that took place. So for example, in matriculation, when the press were hounding me and a few others in this call about the picture, I had to manage my time there. I had to manage doing interviews with newspapers. And, you know, it was really quite challenging. For things like that, timetabling may not be as effective because it has sort of an emotional toll on you, especially when people are in the comment section on the Daily Mail calling you Zulu warriors. It can do something to you. So with things like that, I really turned to my family, my mom especially. She was really there for me and she supported me throughout my childhood. And she's someone that I think can turn to. So I'd say there's two things. I'd say both manage your time, and where that doesn't suffice, turn to the people that you're close to and just ask them for advice, because at the end of the day, that's really what helps. And those are the people who have got your back.
Cool. So we're going to open up questions to everyone. So anyone can ask, you know, serious questions, a joke question, etc. I'll remind you, basically the way to kind of ask a question, react. So put like a little heart if you want, whatever. So yeah, okay. Layla, you can unmute yourself.
Hi. So my question is, well, it's more of a statement, but it will lead to a question. I really found with ACS that it's quite difficult to have conversations surrounding race and colorism that kind of reaches out to everybody. How will you ensure then that these important conversations are had and are not, I don't know, are not continue to be overlooked?
I'll happily take that question. Thank you, Layla. Definitely, I think those are really, really important issues. Speaking from my personal experience, in my previous school, I held a position on my Afro-Caribbean society, and we used to hold events every 2 weeks, very, very similar to the form of Ox Chat that you guys have, which is why I was really happy to see that that was an event here, where we would take topics that were commonly discussed on Twitter or just in the wider Black community, and we would make sure we discussed those in depth. And I feel like through bringing back a gem of the society, Ox Chat, back in next year, I feel like in that sense, we can really, really get into depth and discuss the topic of race and, you know, all the other things as well. So I think through events like Ox Chat, and I think it would be much better as well if we could get in person, because just having those kind of discussions in person where people are bouncing off each other with their ideas, you know, maybe a bit of laughs here and there, and, you know, some food, I think that would be a really good thing to have there.
Sorry, colorism, yeah. This is a really important topic. Of course, it always needs discussion. But I think discussion without action is, it's quite challenging. I think we definitely need to have more talks about it. And I also mentioned in my, in my manifesto about Oxchat. But I think an element lacking in that is that sometimes the ACS can be a bit too insular. I think awareness within our own community, is important. So we need to understand what we're all talking about in terms of within the ACS, but within the wider university, maybe other people need to know about these issues as well, because that's where issues can arise with people outside our society. So I think an important thing is to maintain a discussion both within the ACS and both outside the ACS, and keep those issues in, bring those issues to the fore so that everybody's aware of the issues facing Black people within Oxford.
I think Mary?
Yeah, I had a question, and it's quite a simple one. What motivates both of you to be ACS president? Like, what is the motivation behind it?
Should I go? I'll go. For me, what motivates me is I just want to inspire people. as I mentioned in my speech, growing up, people around me weren't really supportive of my ambitions. They weren't. I didn't really have people like that in my life, apart from my mom. She was my number one supporter. Everybody else kind of just looked down on me and just they didn't really see me to be where I am today. I want to kind of curb that by working with the people in the ACS, by uplifting them, and only in doing that can we really inspire the people that aren't actually at Oxford yet. So by creating good events for the people in the ACS, creating fun events for the people in the ACS, by connecting them to careers, we can really encourage people who aren't currently at university, African and Caribbean people, to apply. And that's really what I want to do as ACS, and what motivates me to run for ACS president.
Yeah, in terms of motivation, I would definitely say that, of course, the ACS is my family. And before I joined Oxford University, I had some instances that occurred within my own household where, you know, it really brought to light the fact that I had to sort of make the step up to sort of support the people around me, support my mum, who's currently a single mother. I had to get the grades, everything, so I become that pillar for my family. Now, fast forward to Oxford, I have to also consider that the ACS is now also my family. And I also want to benefit the ACS in the same way that I did and I'm trying to do currently for my family at home. I've tried to do this through several events, through several mediums. I mean, I've participated in admissions live streams where I've, you know, tried to help prospective applicants with the Oxbridge application process. And I've even connected with a few prospective applicants as well, answering their questions on classics, the subject that I study, also some questions on Oxford more generally. I've been on the YouTube channel and I've also been participating in Shadowing Week. And now happily, I'm leading a team, the team of facilitators for our annual access conference that's happening in summer, so I can benefit the people of our society. However, the issue with this is I'm a junior access officer and I'm very, very happy with the job that I'm doing. Don't get me wrong. And I'm benefiting prospective applicants, but that is only part of my vision, only part of my vision. I want to benefit everybody. I want to cater to all the forms of our society, prospective, present, and past, empower and unify. And that's something that I can't do with the role that I've currently got. And as president, my vision, that is my vision. And I'm hoping that through doing this, through becoming your president, I can benefit everybody and cater to everybody in the society rather than just one medium.
Cool. So I think so we saw like five people put their hands up. I think, so Iman did first. So remember this, you lot, yeah? We'll go to Iman, then Amjad, Esther, Adam, Miles, and Sarah. Cool. So we've queued it up. Deborah says she had her hands up. Okay, cool. But first we'll go to Iman. Deborah, we'll get to everyone, don't worry.
I'm happy for Deborah to go if she wants to go first.
okay, Deborah, you can go.
Oh no, I wasn't desperate or anything, but okay, I have a question for Josh specifically. You said about having like a woman's rep, and that's definitely something that I would love to see in the ACS. Especially you talked about the whole posting the photo thing and you getting abused. I also got a lot of abuse about that photo as well, but I didn't get a lot of support from like anyone apart from like Miles King and all the boys in the photo. Like no one reached out to say, oh, you okay? Like it was all silent. So I wanted to ask, what would you say would you want your women's rep to do, like in terms of initiatives? What would their roles be like? What would they do for women in the ACS?
Okay, first of all, I just wanted to apologize for not if I didn't reach out to you and supporting you while we both went through the same abuse. Secondly, the women's rep is really to tackle issues that face Black women. As a Black man, it's not for me to determine what issues there are. I can hazard a guess because some of the issues there is overlap, but there's some certain issues facing Black women which are very, very specific to Black women, and it's only Black women who can really bring those issues to the fore. Some of them, as I've mentioned, is discrimination and also internal disputes between Black men and Black women. But I think the real key person to tackle that is a Black woman, and that's what I want the women's representative within the ACS to do, to talk about those issues, to discuss those issues, to make sure that people are understanding it both within the ACS and within the wider university. And yeah, tackling those issues together with the support of the executive body and myself as the president.
Cool. Iman?
My question is just, I guess there's a lot of talk about like prospective students, and this is open to both of you, by the way, prospective students and like doing things access wise for students who are potentially coming to Oxford and joining the ACS. But more specifically for students, for example, like I'm thinking classics and law, which surprisingly both of you study, for example, like, and psychologists who have like mods in first year and second year and then prelims for every, like for in Trinity for I think most of the other subjects. What kind of welfare or support would you have for current ACS students? Because it, obviously in our first year, it was so much easier because we had in-person events and I was able to speak to people a lot easier. And so me reaching out to some of my friends at the moment to ask for like help with the subject I'm studying. If I'm stuck on something, it's so much easier, but I don't know how that's going to pan out, obviously, now or even in the future. So what kind of support would you provide for students academically, not just thinking, you know, post-grad, because there's a lot of focus on what job you're going to go into and stuff, but not really like how you're tackling your exams at the moment, or like, you know, even like note support from other ACS members.
So with regards to this question, I think it's quite, I think the ACS families does tackle this somewhat, but I think there could be more to be done. In terms of like academics as well, I completely understand, because I've got mods in 3 or 4 weeks. So I think having ACS group chats based around subjects, so for example, if I have a Lord group chat, or even on Microsoft Teams, or we could have a Teams Drive where people upload their notes, upload their, you know, their essays, and support students in that way. In a similar way with the ACS families, you could have a more robust system where you obviously link people with people on their subjects, and then you schedule calls, perhaps maybe, for example, it'd work in second week, fourth week, and eighth week, or something along those lines. But yeah, those are two ways in which I'd like to tackle that. So for example, first with the group chats, the subject specific group chats, and then, you know, making the ACS families more robust, which allow the parents to provide more support on a regular basis through, I don't know, through video calls or maybe in person, socially distant. Yeah.
I'd like to reiterate what Josh said in one sense. I do feel like the family system is one way which support and welfare can be instilled. Obviously, your discussions, I feel like they need to be more robust. The family system hasn't been the best this year, in my opinion. And I feel like we need to strengthen that. And through that, we can increase welfare on a more connected level. However, I don't think that's particularly the place where subject help can come, because naturally, if you think about the difference, like the difference in subjects, the different amounts of how many people do in different subjects, you can't really give, in a sense, you can't have one ACS parent going, you know, it doesn't really match, if that's what I'm trying to convey, is that there's a large number of people doing law and PPE, but there's a small number, as you've already expressed, there's a small number of Black people doing subjects like classics. So how are we going to take that into account with the ACS family system? So I don't think that's particularly the place that you would go to in order for subject advice, sorry, Josh. But I think the group chat idea is very, very good. I think the group chat idea we should definitely have. And in terms of other areas where we can support welfare, I had the idea of sending out a form every 2 weeks or so, a form, because a lot of people are afraid to come clean about their concerns, their academic concerns, and, you know, personal stuff that has gone on within their family and with so on and so forth that's affecting their academics. So I thought that possibly with the ACS newsletter, we could sort of gauge how each person is sort of feeling during the week or every 2 weeks, because a senior welfare officer, it's very difficult for a senior welfare officer to oversee every ACS member. I mean, it's borderline impossible, which is another reason why I wanted to introduce the freshers rep, because the freshers rep will be able to be the first point of call for the freshers year. They'll be able to understand their concerns, and if so, they can refer some freshers to the senior welfare officer for some more assistance. But this form will allow us to gauge the sort of mental state of our members on a more isolated sense, so that senior welfare officer can then check on those people, and then that can happen that way.
Okay, cool. Amjad?
Hi. I just wanted to ask for both candidates, what do you think makes you suitable? Like, what personal experiences do you have that makes you suitable to tackle the issues that you guys spoke about in your manifesto? Because I think it's all good saying, you know, I want to tackle access or I want to tackle this, but if you don't really understand it, it can be very hard to implement it well. So, yeah, I want to hear that.
Should I go? Yeah. Well, for starters, as you said, you know, you need to understand it. I think that's a really important thing. Well, as the access officer, I feel like I do have a good understanding of what access is like and how it's conducted within the Oxford ACS. So I feel like I'd be able to facilitate that and take it to the newer heights. I've, you know, participated in lots of live streams and stuff. So I've sort of been able to connect with prospective applicants in a really nuanced way. So this will allow me to then introduce and level it up by taking Access Up North to Manchester, which I think is our next step. And I feel like one thing that I haven't really covered so far is that at the end of the day, as Aman has said, like academic concerns are really, really important among ACS members. And really and truly, we all have degrees. So it's really difficult to balance ACS work and your academics. So I feel like it's taking those baby steps. That's what I'm trying to convey to all of you. Manchester, by doing Manchester, hopefully the committee after me will think that, you know, let's start, you know, doing some more access work in other different areas. But I feel like it's more directing the ACS to a sort of more less London centric kind of idea there. But yeah, I think that's how I'd answer that.
As someone who lives in the North, I'd really like to take issue with that answer. I think targeting on Manchester is a good step forward for the ACS, but I don't think it really tackles the issues that I mentioned earlier on in my manifesto, simply because Manchester, just targeting Manchester would be replicating the problem we have with London elsewhere. I think what we should do instead is use our members, because our members, although a lot of us do, well, a lot of our members do come from London, there are many of us who don't. I live in Bradford, there are other people who live in Leeds, people who live in Teesside, etc. Using those members to reach out to the schools in their areas, forming links with them and, you know, creating access. I think that's what I resonate with, and that's how I can bring my experiences to the role, because I've experienced the lack of access. You know, Target Oxford, you know, works primarily in London. So yeah, I'd really like to engage all our members in our access efforts, not just those with committee roles.
Cool, so I'll keep going through the list. We've got a few questions, so let's just try to keep the questions a bit shorter, and then obviously the answers a bit shorter as well. Next person is Esther.
Perfect, thank you. So that's actually what I was gonna say. So two things that are really important. One of them is time management, and another one is being able to separate your personal friendships that you've made over the last year with like the ACS work that you're gonna be doing. So I'm gonna set a timer for 30 seconds for each of you to answer this question. I'm not gonna have that out loud, so just, you know, guess 30 seconds. But what practical steps will you take to ensure that you can effectively and efficiently create that divorce between friendship and like ACS work without completely breaking that friendship?
I think the answer to your question lies in the question, in the topic. For me, it's time management, just making sure you divide your time equally. I already do this with my work, my academics, dividing your time equally between what you need to do for the ACS and the friendships that you need to maintain.
Yeah, I'd like to reiterate that point, but also I think that there's an extra dimension to that question, because what happens if your friends are also on committee as well? I feel like, you know, you're all sort of, you know, you've all got work to do for the ACS, and obviously conflict can tend to arise in certain aspects as Sean has mentioned within this call, you know. So I feel like in that sense, I feel like the best thing to do is sort of keep having regular discussions with your friends, keep having regular discussions about the work that you're going through. And if you're the president, of course, you're going to be the person overseeing all of this work that is being carried out within the society. So if there's any issues that are arising, then I feel like it's best to nip them in the bud early and have good conversations so that your friendships don't break, because it would be a shame to break your friendship over the society, which in essence is supposed to unify us. It's supposed to keep us a family, yet, you know, you're letting your work tear you apart. So I'd say, yeah, if you're in the committee, that does raise that sort of extra dimension to that question as you're asking.
Thanks for that, you guys. Adam?
Classic. Basically my question is, by the end of like being ACS president, if you were ACS president, what is the one thing that you would feel incredibly proud to have like achieved? What's the one tangible thing? Like, I don't want to hear anything cooperation, integration, give me something specific, like something very pinpointed.
In my manifesto, I mentioned specific statistics about the amount of people who had been admitted to Oxford. 3% of Black students made up the freshers this year. I'd like to see that number increase. I'm not saying that I could, I'm not, you know, establishing or saying it's a certainty that I would increase it, but I'd like to see that number increase. I think the ACS is the key way that that can be done. I've talked so much about, you know, the access initiatives I'm willing to implement. And if I can bring that, if I can make that come to pass through my role as president, I would be very, very happy, because that's the key motivation. As I said before, I want to inspire people. And if in doing my role, I inspire people to apply to Oxford, and that's a visible thing, a tangible thing that I can see, a statistic that I can see has changed, that would be amazing. So that's a specific thing that I'd want to see different at the end of my presidency.
I would say the thing that I'd like to see, I mean, alongside obviously increasing access and seeing more Black students come into the university, I think that unification is one big thing that I've been speaking about, but like more specifically, I want to see more interaction with our alumni and the present society. I mean, you know, I don't feel like there's, other than the Meet the Sponsors event that we have this year, there's not that much interaction. We don't really get to sort of connect with our alumni. So it's great to see, you know, it's great to speak to Esther on this chat, you know, and have her asking us questions. But like, you know, I feel like with the family reunion event, I think that's sort of the kind of like, that's the event that I'm really, really hoping that we can that can happen. And I'm really, really excited for that. It will be really, really great to see our present members sort of speaking with like all of our past members, having conversations with them, sort of, you know, throwing back and forth sort of experiences that we've had at the university, all of that. It's that connection, it's keeping us all connected. Aside from this, I also plan to liaise with the Oxford Black Alumni Network, which is something completely different. It's just sort of the alumni, the Black alumni of Oxford, and also, you know, organizing careers events with them, getting them to come in more. And I feel like with that, we can really have a unified society, because I feel like the term family, you can't really call us a family if as soon as you leave, you're sort of separated and annexed from the society. I feel like we need to be connected in the same way that we're focusing on increasing access with students from London and outside of London. I feel like we should also be connecting our alumni with us so we can maintain this family structure and, you know, really make the ACS what it really should be, a strong family.
Okay, Miles?
Hi guys. So I think it's kind of fair to say that the last year has been quite tumultuous in terms of being a Black person. For example, kind of like the end SARS movement, obviously Black Lives Matter, the recent Ugandan elections, and kind of various other political events that have happened which affect our communities. So I wanted to ask you guys, like, to what extent do you think that the ACS should involve itself in facilitating discussion on these matters and educating in terms of what is going on in Africa and the Caribbean respectively? And if you think that's something that the ACS should be doing, what do you guys think under your presidency you would like to introduce in order to facilitate those discussions?
Yeah, I think this is,
I think this is an important, very important discussion, but I think what's more important is to distinguish between politics and social issues. The Oxford ACS is a society there for Black people, there for North Africans, there for Caribbeans, there for people of African Caribbean descent. And it's supposed to speak on issues that matter to them. On the other hand, it's not a political organization in the sense that it's not politically partisan. Issues that affect Black people have to be spoken about. Issues that affect African and Caribbean people have to be spoken about. Through the Oxchat discussions, I'd like to bring these to the fore. For example, the things that have happened with George Floyd, the things that happened with the end SARS movement, those are issues affecting Black people. Those things that happen in Uganda, for example, those are issues affecting Ugandans, and they need to be spoken about. In terms of the actual politics, I don't think that we should get involved with politics, because the ACS is in a society that includes all African and Caribbean people, not based on their political beliefs. So it should tackle issues that affect African Caribbean people, but not divide them along, you know, partisan lines in terms of party politics. So yeah, as I said before, I'd like to tackle this through the Oxford discussions. Yeah, to bring these issues to the fore, both internally and externally.
Yeah, I think that was a really, really good question, Miles. And I feel like, yes, we do need to increase discussion about these political instances. Of course, we will have events to do this, but also I feel like educating is also a really important thing. And that's something I really want to push forward as well. I don't know if any of you have chanced to see around the time of NSARS, Oxford ACS actually produced a sort of Instagram post sort of explaining kind of what's happening on that. And I think that needs to continue. That definitely has to continue because we need to educate our members about what's happening in the African and Caribbean community. Like, at the end of the day, this is what we are. I feel like you can't completely separate us from what is happening within our own countries. And also it's beneficial because we're all part of this society, African Caribbean society, but we're all from different areas at the end of the day. And it would be nice to know, it would be nice for someone maybe from Nigeria to understand what's happening in Uganda. And so that you can help, you can stand in solidarity with them. It would be nice for me to understand what's going on in Nigeria. And I think that those are really, really essential. And I feel like through Oxchat, we can talk about these things, sure, but we also do need to educate. And I feel like we need to continue. Whenever we see these political issues happening, we need to release these Instagram posts. We need to be educating our members. And obviously we'll all be sharing them as we always do with the ACS. We keep on sharing, we mobilize, we stand together because that's what we are at the end of the day. So yeah, I think that that's really, really important. And I really, really hope next year we increase that sort of political discussion and we stand in solidarity with all our African and Caribbean people.
Wonderful. Sarah? Yeah.
Skip me, sorry. I had a question, but skip me, it's okay.
Are you sure? Okay. Then Danielle?
Hi, sorry, yeah, no mic, no camera from me. I just think, okay. So I feel like a lot of the discourse, which other people brought up, has been very much like the future, careers kind of based, but also very like accessy as well, which is fine. But kind of as someone, so I'm a creative, I'm also just like not down for like sitting at an office and doing work. I'm also a bit of a communist, so like that's there too. And I feel like there's this interesting kind of structure at Oxford where because these corporate companies know that societies have to thrive from their money, so they give us a lot of money, and in doing that we have to like put events on for them and stuff like that. So in order for the ACS to survive, we need money. We go to sponsors, they're often corporate, they give us money, we put on events for them, and that's when we can get this saturation of the corporate like world. And my question is about this fact that, like, for me, Oxford is very hostile, like all the time. It's part to do with the course I do. It's also the fact that, like, we've seen things that you guys haven't. We saw Oxford discovering race last year. We saw in like 5 weeks into term, we saw a blind black man called Ebenezer Azamati being dragged out of the Oxford Union. Like, those are things we had to deal with. We had to deal with the UN women inviting Amber Rudd, who deported Windrush generation people, being invited to speak at International Women's Day, things like that. And so in those cases where like the violence perpetrated against black people in the university is inherently political, it is difficult for me to hear answers like we should be able to separate politics when my existence in this space is inherently political. But also it's difficult for me to not hear anything to do with like trying to make this space less hostile. And I think it's a good thing that you guys have come and been able to not see anything like really bad. But when I like go to my lecture and my lecturer says something real violent about the slave trade, and I'm not hearing anything from like potential presidential candidates on how they think that they have to interact with the legacy of the violence that is at Oxford, is difficult for me. So basically, to rattle down the question, I'm sorry I ranted, how are you going to engage with like the realities of students here that have to experience violence all the time? How are you going to like create events that engage with students not just so that they can go and like be a corporate person and make money, but so that they don't want to leave every week when they're in Oxford.
Yeah, I just want to say that, yeah, that was really powerful. And I think one thing that really does need to be done is we do need to fight for all of our ACS members. You're really correct in that regard. There's things that Josh and I haven't seen, for sure. We joined this year, and before our time, there were so many racial encounters, racial instances that shouldn't have actually happened at this university. And I feel like one of the ways we can combat this, of course, this whole race equality task force has been, you know, inaugurated, but I'm yet to see anything actually happen out of that. I feel like it's more just a title. I don't think anything is actually happening. It's got the pro vice chancellor within it and some members of our ACS committee inside it as well. But we need to make change for sure. And that is something that is certain. For one thing, I feel like, you know, I want to talk about sort of making sure the welfare of our ACS African and Caribbean students is intact. And then I'll sort of try and diverge into sort of how possibly we can make change with the sort of, you know, the sort of atmosphere at Oxford and how it's violent towards our people. Firstly, we only have two Black counsellors at Oxford University. And I think this is a real issue. And this is something that previous committees have been discussing, like, they've been in constant discussion with the university. We need more Black counselors because at the end of the day, this is a violent place for us. Like, there are so many instances that you hear about, and it's really sad. It's sad for me and all of us on this call to hear about these situations happening. And when it turns somebody within our society to a sort of state of mental health, you know, they feel depressed about what's going on and they want to seek help with a counselor that they can actually discuss this with, they're referred to a white counselor. And of course you can't discuss race with a white counselor, of course, like it's obvious. So the fact that there's only two Black counselors means that really and truly, you're gonna be on the waiting list for a long time and it's gonna be really difficult for you to continue academics. We need to push for this. We need more Black counselors. So next year, I'm hoping that as a society, we need to apply pressure. We really do need to apply pressure on the university because this is not on. This is something that's been going on for years and it can't happen again. So the welfare concerns for us, for our members is something that needs to happen. As for sort of changing the environment within the university, I feel like in one sense, the ACS sort of, whenever these situations happen, we usually send out statements. We work externally, to be honest, from the society, from Oxford University. We're not even part of the official list of registered societies. So we usually apply pressure for our statements with, you know, with the Dina Rose situation, all of that. But I feel like in one sense, although we do this, you know, with college and especially instances within college, like racial instances there, they're really autonomous. So they can easily sort of pass our statements to the side and not even, you know, take them into account. So I feel like something needs to change, something needs to happen. So I feel like rather than, you know, just relying on this racial equality task force to do everything for us, because realistically it won't, I feel like we need to have proper discussions with the university next term. We need to go to this pro vice chancellor and we need to say, no, these things need to happen now. I think we need to come up with some sort of stuff, some sort of guidelines for them to follow. And, you know, they need to tackle and, you know, clamp down on racism much harshly, because it just feels like when they hear about it, it's sort of something that they just like push to the side. And this is something that's not on, because at the end of the day, this is our lives, this is our education. And, you know, I feel like much, much more care needs to be handled with our African and Caribbean students. So definitely, I feel like the ACS as a society, it needs to be a bit more forceful, because this whole statement approach is good and all when it works, but in the event that it doesn't work, it can leave our members feeling stranded. I mean, for example, like I said, Sean sort of sent out an email to my college because they weren't allowing me to come back. And there were some certain situations happening at home for me, which, you know, I couldn't sort of handle, and it was going to affect my academics. And, you know, they rejected me from coming back at the end, which is really, really annoying. And that just proved to me how autonomous these colleges are. So when you see all of these sort of statements being released to the colleges, you know, basically saying, you know, we were not happy about this sort of racial thing that happens within it, they're just passing it to the side. So I definitely feel like this is an issue which needs to be taken higher up the university rather rather than focusing on sort of the base level. So yeah, I really support and I stand by with what you said, and I also stand in solidarity, and I feel like we need to do this. This is something that needs to happen. We've been raising these issues for years, as you know, because you've been here longer than me. So yeah, I'm really on board with this.
I just like to support everything Aaron said. I think this is one thing we can certainly 100% agree on. With regards to my answer about separating politics from social issues, what I meant to say is that the ACS is a society that is there, as I said in my at the start of this question session, is there to act as a voice for people of African and Caribbean descent. Anything that tries to stifle that voice, the ACS needs to rise up and stand against it. That is completely true. There's no controversy about that. So yeah, exactly what he said about putting pressure on the university to do more, because I feel like whereas there are some colleges who are trying, there are other colleges who are very, very apathetic to the issues that are facing us. I won't name any specific colleges, but I'm sure you all know. The way that university operates in its federal system is not really conducive to attacking issues of race. So yeah, I think what needs to happen is that we as the ACS, as the voice for Black people within Oxford University, as a voice for people of African Caribbean descent within this university, we need to stand up against that and put pressure. I want to put pressure on, on the university as an organization and say that racism is not welcome. I mean, I've firsthand experienced it. My story is published nationwide, and I got reams and reams and reams and reams of racial abuse, people saying that I'm race-baiting, people not willing to believe our stories, which is why those stories also need to be heard. I think the platform where we can share stories, similar to Walk in My Shoes, but it's specifically about racist issues that have happened, so people know what's going on. Because the key thing I felt that was understanding is people thought that it was so wild for someone to reject someone on the basis that they are Black and it's not good for business. People won't believe that because they think that we live in a diverse and inclusive society, when it's not true at all. That was the key thing I struggled with when I was going through that, not being believed. That's why I didn't want to say anything. But I think we need to be courageous in that sense and tell our stories, tell the stories, the experiences that we've had of racism, create a platform that specifically talks about those issues. And only in doing that can we really, really address the issues that are going on, and can we really, walk in solidarity with people who are going through those same issues.
Yeah, no, that was great. I think Effie has a relevant question, also being on the Race Equality Task Force. So Effie?
Hey, sorry guys, I definitely jumped in the queue, and no camera from me either because Sis is really doing her hair. But, and also shameless plug, I am the ACS representative on the Race Equality Task Force. So if anybody has anything they want to bring up, please send me a message. The next meeting is on March 8th or around that time. So as a person who's actually had experience in speaking to the Pro Vice Chancellor and all these other people, the powers that be within the university, about how the university has discovered race like 20 minutes ago, and making our lived experiences aware to the people who actually have some sort of power to change it, I wanted to know what your approach would be, especially given that a lot of the time their responses are, we actually have no power over what the colleges do or what the faculties do, especially when they say a lot of these things are not going to happen within your time here, and you're probably not going to be able to see the real effects. So like, and it's also, I would say, very emotionally draining to see things, to just feel so powerless, and to also have to represent every single Black student that sets foot in Oxford. So I just wanted to know, like, how would you approach going through that and approach speaking to some white man, probably through a Zoom screen, about your very Black problems, also not being able to, also not being able to relate to a lot of the experiences yourself, given the constraints of, sexuality and gender as well. So how would you go about approaching these really difficult conversations?
I think that my approach can be summed up in one word, solidarity. This is intrinsically linked what I talked about in connecting with other ACSs. These issues aren't unique to Oxford, they're not unique to Cambridge, this happened all over the country. Last term in Manchester, I'm sure you've all seen that boy who was stopped by the security in the University of Manchester for simply walking to his accommodation. They just assumed, I don't know what they assumed of him, but yeah, he was a victim of a racial attack. Solidarity with ACSs is so important because we all go through the same kind of, we go through the same issues, and connecting with our counterparts at other universities and showing that there's a solidarity among the African and Caribbean population across the UK is a really good way of, what's it called, tackling these issues in terms of the university authorities. For example, signing petitions, presidents of the ACSs across the country signing a petition and bringing it to our vice chancellors and saying that we're standing against this and these are racial issues. Our voices must be heard, and you know, solidarity is the only way we can achieve this. Maybe one ACS president isn't able to do that, but together with a bunch of other leaders from across the country, from across different backgrounds, I would hope that would have some substantial effect on the leadership's approach to racial inequality and racial injustice.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think standing in solidarity is something that we need to do, because ultimately this isn't just an issue at Oxford. Of course it is. I mean, the amount of Black people at Oxford is categorically way less than other universities, but this is a problem everywhere. And I feel like as Oxford ACS is concerned with the wider Black community, we do need to stand in solidarity to address these issues. But also on another form, I feel like the ACS, when we see these colleges, you know, sort of using their autonomy to sort of brush past all of these racial instances that are going on, I feel like one thing that we can turn to is, you know, other powers outside the university. Maybe we can release sort of in the student newspapers, sort of, I mean, the ACS has already sort of done this in the past. They've threatened colleges that, you know, we're gonna sort of, you know, get the person to speak up in an article, you know, and come forward about their experience so their voice can be heard. I feel like getting people's voice heard is something that's really important, because it will even help us all stand in solidarity with them, because not only will it be us, it'll be also the white people as well standing in solidarity with that one person. Because ultimately, colleges, although they're autonomous, really and truly, they care about their reputation. Reputation is what is really important for them. So if they see something that's going to affect their reputation, then they'll finally realize that the power has been stripped from them. So I feel like that would be a really good way of doing this, taking it to the student newspapers and maybe even beyond, because really and truly, racism is something that should not be going on in Oxford or in any other universities. So I feel like standing in solidarity with other ACS presidents, other universities, is something we should also do. But then I also think that we should, you know, maybe take this into the public sphere, because it's so hard, it's really, really hard to get into contact with colleges and get them to sort out these issues when they're completely neglecting everything we say. So, you know, let's apply that pressure in another sense. Let's take this higher up, because this needs to change.
Okay.
I think Noah raised a really good question.
I was about to say, both of you should respond.
Standing in solidarity, I think what the question is hinting at is it is a very vague term. I'm always someone who says that words aren't enough, you know, action needs to be done. For me, what standing in solidarity means to me is collective action against these instances of racism. So collective action, as Aaron said, would be, you know, publishing an article, signed by, I don't know, leaders of the ACS across the different universities, saying that we're standing against this, having a list of those experiences published and condemning these universities for their apathy in terms of racial discrimination. Standing in solidarity could also be creating a series of videos, creating a series about, as I said before, racial experiences that people have faced, saying that this is not okay and we're standing against this. Standing in solidarity could be holding a convention with a range of pro-vice chancellors, I'm publishing it, talking about these issues and saying, why hasn't anything been done thus far? Why hasn't anything been done? Why are people being rejected from jobs because of their skin color? Why are people being called Zulu warriors for trying to promote black access to universities? Why is all of this happening? Why has nothing been done from the university? You know, everybody saw the article that happened, you know, when it happened, when it went on earlier this January. I didn't hear anything from the university's governing board. I heard something from my college principal, and that was it. The rest of my college didn't even bother to message me officially and fight against that. I think all of us coming together and challenging these people, challenging the perpetrators of this racism, challenging the race apologists on their actions, is standing in solidarity. And it causes them to really confront themselves and really think, what am I doing? Like, I think that's what really needs to be done. All we can do is challenge them and force them to recognize what's going on. How they respond to it, we don't have any control over it, but standing in solidarity is a key way that we can kind of force a reaction. You know, when more people hear about the stuff that is going on, the stuff that's affecting us, yeah, they're more likely to join the force, because a lot of times people just think that, oh, nobody cares, what's the point of raising it? I've had so many instances when I've talked to freshers here, even for silly things, even for things that seem small, like a porter failing to pronounce your name properly, or saying, oh, you check, I don't know, board carding you and letting a bunch of white people go through, stuff like that. People take this as just like a normal part of everyday life, and it's not really challenged, it's not really confronted. Yeah, people are scared to bring it up. I think challenging the those in leadership positions over these instances and saying, no, we're not allowing this, that's what standing in solidarity is for me.
Cool. Yeah, so.
Yeah, me?
Yeah, all right. Sorry, no, my thing just bugged. Wi-Fi is moving mad right now. But okay. So the next question then is from Ruth. Ruth?
Me? Did I put my hand up? Or is there another Ruth? I'm the only Ruth here.
No, I think you're the only Ruth here.
Okay, good. So yeah. The question I have is, how do you, so the two candidates running, plan to make ACS a safe space for Black people, so for Black students who are coming in to an inherently quite, you know, violent and very white area, which is dominated by everybody non-Black? How do you plan to make sure it is a safe space for where discussions can be had, which are productive in nature, where we don't need to tiptoe as if, you know, I'm sat in a room with like all of my white tutors, where we don't have to tiptoe around key topics? So how do you plan to do that? Because in the past, I'm sure other people who are from like previous years, if you're not in first year, you all know there have been instances where people have been like, oh, let's not talk about that. Let's not talk about race. We need to talk about race, okay? You're Black. It's something like you almost can't fight. You can't hide. It's kind of like, you know, it's something that is attached to you. So how do you plan to make this place safe in order for people to feel comfortable talking about these key sorts of issues that affect them? Because even if it is the case that you get more mentors and stuff like that, it needs to be the case that people can actually just sit down together when you have these meetings and openly discuss things which are happening to one another without feeling that, oh, because I'm talking about race, I might hurt the feelings of a non-Black person in this room. That shouldn't be the case, and it's happened before, and I don't want to see that happen again, because I'm personally someone who's quite happy to talk about this, but there are other people who won't feel comfortable enough to do that, and they'll sit and they'll ruminate with these things, and you know, it will negatively affect somebody else's mental health. So I want to know, how do you plan to deal with that?
I completely agree with you. I feel like we should not have to tiptoe. We need to be able to address these ideas. We need to be able to have these discussions. I mean, for our year, because all of our events have been virtual and there hasn't really been much sort of involvement of white people within our society. But from what I've heard, you know, white people sometimes used to attend.
Sorry to interrupt you, Aaron. I'm not just talking about white people. I'm talking about non-Black people. Okay. So that includes everybody, including Asian people as well, because oftentimes these places or these safe spaces, so to speak, are encroached by them because of their proximity to Black. So please, please make sure we include Asian people as well.
Yeah, white people, Asian people. Thank you for clarifying that. White people, Asian people, they attended ACS events when they were in person. But, you know, there are specific events, I feel like, that are only put on for members of the African and Caribbean society, are Black members. And I feel like we should sort of, I feel like with the sort of racial discussions that we have, the sort of Ox chat discussions we have about issues of racism, I feel like we should keep those with members who are people who are actually within the society. Because as you say, it can get really, really problematic when there are people who are not Black sort of within that room and they're thinking, oh, I don't feel like I really want to address this idea. I don't really want to talk about this specific topic. But it's a topic that affects all of us. It's something that literally affects African and Caribbean people, which is why we set it as the agenda. And that's why I feel like restricting those sort of discussions and those sort of events to for people who are African and Caribbean is something that we should all endeavor to, is something that the society should endeavor to do, because it can get really problematic. And what's to say when, if we did open it up to everybody and we were actually ended up having a lot of Asian and white involvement in an event like this, that it wouldn't just dominate us in our kind of own sort of space, which would then again sort of make us feel a bit more sort of reserved at the fact that, hang on, we wanted to discuss ideas with other Black people. However, we're being told not to. This is our society at the end of the day. And what we discuss is what we want to discuss. And I feel like we need to be able to discuss our experience, because our experience at Oxford is not one, it's not all happiness. We go through violence. That's something that all of us go through. And I feel like we need to definitely address it, because if it's not addressed, it will never ever change. And I think picking up on what Josh said earlier as well on this similar nature, I feel like we need to be able to sort of challenge as well. It's not just speaking about these things, it's challenging, because even the sort of mini microaggressions that all of us face on a daily basis, some people choose to just let it slide and go and walk away. But I don't think that's correct, because you need to have that idea in your head that if it's not you, it's someone else. So you've gone through this experience, sure, fair enough. And you're telling me that you want to just let that slide because a porter said something a bit racist to you or sort of made you feel uncomfortable, because tomorrow it may be one of your friends. And what are we going to do then? So I feel like we need to be proactive with these kind of things. Not only do we need to be having discussions within our society and keep them with us within our society, allowing it just to be African and Caribbean students, I feel like we should also be challenging every single sort of microaggression we face, so that in the hopes of our members facing less microaggressions in the future. Thank you.
I really like this question because, again, I feel like I can really, really, really relate to it. I feel like it kind of hints to my issues with the problem of the classification BAME, because it recognizes there's an issue between white people being racist to people of color, but it doesn't recognize, as someone mentioned before, issues of colorism, issues of Asian people being racist to Black people, issues of, like, those issues are so, so, so important. And I feel like they need to be addressed. I do see a problem with tackling us as an us versus them problem, because the ACS is a space and a center for African and Caribbean people. But that means that we should be able to talk freely, whether people are there or whether they aren't. It's not like we have to hide. We shouldn't have to hide and say, oh, this is a space merely for Black people, so that's the only way we can feel safe, because that, I don't think that's how society should be. I feel like if we're in a room with someone from Asian heritage, someone from white heritage, be able to confront them directly and say, this is our society and you're in our space and we want to debate the issues that we're facing. That's what challenging is all about. That's what talking about issues that tackle us, that we face, is all about. Talking freely about the issues that we face, and whether they're there or whether they aren't there, we will talk about them regardless. And I think that's what we need to do. That's what I think is
important. Can I quickly just interject? Sorry. No, Josh, I completely agree with what you're saying, but I'm talking about specific instances where there are quite sensitive topics to be discussed, and a lot of people might not feel comfortable. So though you might feel comfortable talking about this, irrespective of who's kind of there are other people in the society who might not speak up because of, you know, who is there, and they might not feel comfortable. So how would you deal with that? How do you balance this need, I guess, to be able to discuss these key topics with other people and other kind of people from different backgrounds and stuff, but also make sure that your members within the society feel safe and comfortable enough to raise these issues? So do you see the point I'm making?
Yeah, I get that. In that case, then it needs to be a balance of the two, because primarily we need to educate people on the issues that we face, and that's a fact. There's no running away from that. But at the same time, we need to cater to people who don't feel safe in those spaces. And in that instance, then yes, you'd have to create like events which are, you know, Black only. Or, but yeah, I think with that problem as well, I think it doesn't recognize the fact that the ACS is more than just Black people as well. So yeah, we need to create like issues where it's Black only and talk about Black experiences. And the same with, you know, people from people like Sean for their experiences and so forth, if they don't feel comfortable talking about it, and create a mix of events which accommodates for those people who do feel comfortable about confronting them head on, and those people who'd rather talk about people who've shared those experiences and want to resonate with each other about what's going on. Does that answer your question?
Okay. Yeah, okay. So the next question on the list, and by the way, I have like 8 more questions. So I'm jobless, so I don't mind just staying and answering the questions, but obviously it's 9 p.m. and I did promise that 9 p.m. it will end. So we will run over. Tosin, do you have a question?
Sorry, let me just find my question. My question is like a bit different to the previous ones that have been asked, but I just wanted to ask, because you both have like made very clear that the ACS seems to be like quite an important thing to both of you, obviously. So I just wanted to ask, like, have you taken part in the ACS beforehand, for example, taking part in events or the committee? And how do you feel this will support your experience and management as president?
I can answer this. It's true. Since I started university, I haven't had that much involvement with the ACS. I've taken part in a few events, such as the Taking Me Out. I'm signed up for the AAC and the offer holiday tomorrow, but I haven't taken an active role, say, in the committee, for example. But I do think the experiences that I have faced, you know, with racism, with dealing with access, by running an access organization, you know, with careers, with you know, helping students to get into Oxford by the interview program that I run, all of whom got places at Oxford for this year coming. I think all of those experiences combined can really, really help me helping to manage the society. For instances where experience would have helped me, I have the team to support. Like I mentioned before, leadership is about, you know, being able to delegate and being able to use the skill sets of the people who are in the team to support your leadership. If you can't do that, whether you've worked in the ACS before or not, you will not be a good leader. You really need to use the people that you're working with in order to succeed as a leader. So yeah, I think those experiences combined with the support of the people on my team would be what would help me as president.
Yeah, so as I mentioned a few times, I'm currently the junior access officer of the Oxford ACS. So I am a committee member, and I feel like that will benefit me as your president, because I have a sort of insight as to what the committee, how it actually runs currently. I mean, I've been able to attend meetings every 2 weeks where we've discussed the agenda, we've talked about some ideas, every single aspect of the society, whether it be the careers officer, whether it be the PR, they've sort of mentioned their sort of queries. We've all sort of worked to solve them, and we've all been pushing the promotion of the society in different manners and different forms. So I feel like that will definitely benefit me next year, taking that into account, because I'll be able to know how the committee is run, and I'll be able to continue and push for that. More specifically with my roles and what I've done, I mean, happily I've had the opportunity to be able to, you know, work towards AAC. I mean, with all the sort of roles, whether it be the sort of help desks that are going to be there, the floaters, the hosts, I've been the sort of person to orchestrate what each person is going to be doing for the event. So I lead the team facilitators, and I'm also involved in recruitment of that event. This is our biggest event, categorically is our biggest event of the year. AAC is our signpost event. And I've been very, very proud to be involved in that. And I feel like that has also given me the opportunity to learn how to actually manage an event and how to run it, because there's so much logistics that actually go into organizing conferences of this nature. And I feel like with so much riding on AAC, I mean, literally think about it, like so many young people come to this thing and they're so excited to speak to Oxford students, so excited to hear about their experiences, so excited to learn about the application process and to even just learn more about their subject, because at the end of the day, these people are academically interested. So I feel like that is something that's really, really important to me. Access, as I've demonstrated throughout this Hustings, access has been very, very important to me. But the ACS is also important to me as well. And the skills I've learned through doing my role, doing my bit as a junior access officer, and also taking into account certain skills that I may have taken from my seniors, Victor and Merrin, who have been very, very great. They've been very, very organized, from the Google Drives we use to sort of deadlines and making sure everything works smoothly. I feel like that is something that anyone can apply. It doesn't even matter if you're going for ACS president. It can just help me in life. I feel like it will help me everywhere, anywhere I go. But obviously, it has a lot of relevance to the role that I'm currently applying for. So yeah, I do think that my current experiences as junior access officer, as a member of the committee, and ultimately as a member of a miniature family, has helped me, and it will continue to help me if I'm able to be your president next year.
Wonderful answer, guys. Omar, you have a question?
Hi, yeah. I think it follows on from the topic of conversation and the feelings within the group. So my question is, how will you go about improving the inclusion of non-Black ACS members and preventing a feeling of marginalization that currently does exist, although some people may not be aware of it?
Yeah. Thank you for asking that question. That's really, really important. Firstly, I feel like we have to put our hands up to Sean, because the cultural committee, I feel like, really does sort this out. Initially, you know, it's really hard to, you know, increase access of sort of the, I mean, lots of different sort of areas within Africa and Caribbean into our African and the Caribbean into our society. But I feel like with the cultural committee, when we have our North African officer, with our East African officer, with our Caribbean officer, with all these different roles available who are each focusing on increasing access into the university regarding their location, regarding sort of other things as well, like bringing in speakers, all of that, I feel like that really does solve the issue. And I feel like we should continue to push forward the cultural committee, because it's essentially just an extension of our current committee. And I feel like that would help mitigate the marginalization that you're talking about. And I'm definitely hoping that I can push that forward.
Sorry, if you don't mind me interjecting quickly before you answer, Josh, in regards to what you said about the North African officer, I'm being totally honest, I don't think that goes far enough. And I feel like there's a lot of exclusivity in regards to the applications and the events that are put forth in the group chat. And now if I'm part of the ACS and I'm constantly receiving applications that are limited to specifically Black students, well, first and foremost, that is great, because we must improve diversity within the corporate sphere. But also, how does that make me feel as someone that I'm not Black, but I'm not white, I'm part of the ACS. So that sort of marginalization does exist, and it needs to be addressed beyond the sphere of North African officer. Because if I'm not being given the opportunities and I'm not being presented with applications that are relevant to me, then what's the point of me being part of the ACS? Because I know a lot of people that haven't joined the ACS because they don't see themselves as Black. And whilst they are of African and Caribbean heritage, it may come across that the ACS is essentially an organization for all Black people. Now, while that isn't necessarily a bad thing, it also needs to improve in terms of its inclusivity with people from backgrounds in Africa and the Caribbean respectively. And I just don't feel like the current standards are doing enough. And I feel like a lot of people aren't aware of this, and there seems to be some sort of us and their mentality within the whole ACS itself. Like that shouldn't exist.
Yeah, no, can I continue to sort of, yeah. Thank you for raising that. Genuinely, I feel like what you're saying is something that definitely needs to be improved. I didn't have any knowledge of this, because I haven't really been sort of, you know, obviously taking into account these applications, these North African officer applications. However, definitely next year, we should definitely push this, because at the end of the day, the whole reason the cultural committee was introduced was to actually tackle what you've just said. It was tackled to reduce this sort of marginalization, to stop people thinking, oh, because I'm from, let's say, Morocco and North Africa, I can't be a sort of I can't be sort of in the sort of interior within the society, I will not be considered because I'm not complete. I don't feel like I'm part of them. I feel like that's something that shouldn't happen. We shouldn't have this us them idea within the ACS because we're all supposed to be unified. Like I said, my vision is unification. And I feel like next year, if this is happening, we should definitely try to put this to a stop, and we should try to increase this sort of engagement with people who are from these different areas. And I hope this doesn't continue for sure.
On the contrary, I think this is a glaring problem, which is why when Chris asked earlier what the biggest problem I see with ACS is identifying why people of African and Caribbean heritage don't want to be part of the society. I think this is a really big problem that needs to be tackled head on. Marginalization of African and Caribbeans who aren't Black is a big problem, and I think it can only be confronted and challenged by hosting events that accommodate for these people with these differences. So for example, hosting cross-culture events where we learn about people's culture Algerian culture, say we learn about Algerian culture, because I think a lot of the events that we do have are specifically targeted to Black people. And like Omar said, a lot of the opportunities that we're provided with are targeted to Black people, for example, the Stephen Lawrence Scholarship. I think creating a society that celebrates diversity both within the university as African and Caribbeans and within the society as people from Southern Africa, people from Northern Africa, people, indigenous Caribbeans, all of those different people, creating a society that fosters that diversity is really important. And that can only be hosted by tackling these three events that celebrate culture, that speak about different cultures, extra to Black culture. Although Black people make up the majority of the ACS, they don't make up the entirety of the ACS. I think that's really important to recognize when leading as president.
Great. Let me just interject my two cents here, because I feel like obviously passions are very high right now. So fundamentally, if we're talking history-wise, the ACS was founded and created, wait for it, as a space for obviously Black students. And I think trying to move away from that, that is something that can obviously fundamentally never happen, because what we need to look at and realize is obviously we all live in a Western world, a racialized world, where the experiences of Black students, for example, for me, I will never experience a lot of the racism like my Black counterparts experience. However, we also still focus on empowering the culture from African and Caribbean nations. So we have these two principles side by side, right? However, these aren't a trade-off. Yeah, just because you boost culture doesn't mean you boost the lack of commitment to Black students. Just because you boost, you know, the commitment to Black students with, you know, specific, you know, Black pathways to, you know, law, investment banking, etc., doesn't mean you obviously undermine the commitment to culture. And then I think, you know, we talked about this last year a lot, and my election to presidency is a testament that the society obviously is very inclusive and is that safe space for African and Caribbean people. And I think, like you said, with the cultural committee offices, which we're still, hopefully next year, have the Central African officer that we still need and the Southern African officer that we still need, we will obviously boost diversity, etc. So we need to, like, you know, move away from this, you know, very binary mindset, right? We can achieve both principles together and in unison. And I think it is a testament to how diverse we're becoming and how inclusive we're becoming. We need to realize that there's no tension there anymore. But at the same time, there is still that onus upon us non-Black students to support our fellow Black students in a lot of the struggles they face, like I said, coming from a racialized world. So while me, for example, if I use my personal experience, like with Caribbean people, it's exactly the same culture. But, you know, if I come to the UK in a racialized white world, they're going to perceive me as a brown boy. Yeah, I'm from Sri Lanka, India, all of them places there. Yeah. And I think that's where obviously non-Black people need to realize where it is their space and why ACS is so crucial to a commitment of a safe space for Black students. I'm glad the conversation is happening, but listen, let's remember these two principles that we have to uphold: culture and race aren't in tension. They're in unison, if anything. And moving on, we have another question from Fatima. So Fatima, if you want to speak.
Yeah, hi. There's been a lot of comments about mental health and a lot of concerns about that. I just wanted to ask, what are the candidates trying to do to improve welfare within the ACS?
Well, do you want to go?
I'll go.
Okay, cool. So definitely, I feel like, as I've already expressed, we only have two senior welfare officers. And how many people are in this society? So many. It's categorically impossible for them to monitor the sort of mental states of all of our students. So I feel like one way that I thought that could change is sort of having a more targeted focus on welfare, because we need to actually have these conversations. We need to know who's sort of feeling low, who's struggling with their academics, as Iman expressed, and all of that, so we can really actually help them. I feel like one way we could have done that was through that sort of form aspect, that sort of, you know, every 2 weeks or so or something like that. Or this may apply more towards the end of the term where, you know, we get those week four blues, those week five blues. Obviously Oxford's really, really stressful. We can sort of do that. Everybody can sort of fill those in to sort of see, we can sort of gauge the sort of mental state of the society on the whole. And we can see the individuals who are in need of sort of attention and who need that sort of support, extra support. So we can actually focus our attention on them and help them out, because at the end of the day, it's really and really and truly is impossible to monitor everybody. And I feel like that is something that needs to happen next year. Also, I feel like we need to push forward our current Welfare Wednesdays. Those need to continue happening, from the sort of Art Attack event that IPTE has been carrying out, and also the mindfulness talks. A lot of people generally like attending those, and I feel like we need to keep those going. But also, hopefully, we can get some more sort of in-person, just genuine discussion events. So, you know, people sitting around a room, just having a little discussion about how Oxford is going. And I'm thinking that maybe every sort of week we can have a welfare event going on. However, of course, I want to continue to maintain the online proficiency that we've sort of developed over the course of this year, thanks to this committee. And I feel like it will sort of rotate. So the first week maybe be an in-person event where we're all discussing, how we're feeling. But then maybe the next week it can take place online, because I feel like, you know, now I feel like maybe more towards the old ACS, I feel like everybody felt that every event had to be in person, but that's not genuinely the case. I feel like some people actually occasionally just want to maybe sit back in their room. They may not want to leave. And I feel like also we need to take into account that everybody's got their own work to do, their degrees. So I feel like having a welfare event every single week would be very, very good. We need to continue our Welfare Wednesdays, but we also need to do targeted welfare, because targeted welfare is what will allow us to literally mitigate the sort of bad things that are happening towards African and Caribbean students within the society.
For me, what I already iterated before, first of all, I'd just like to say, I agree with everything that Aaron's mentioned. I think those are all very, very good points. But also, I think we should start with the basics first. There's no women's representative yet. How are we supposed to tackle the welfare of Black women without a person who can speak for their needs? It's not possible. So I think that needs to be sorted first. Secondly, college reps. Again, how can we have a contact with colleges if we don't have someone who can, you know, speak up for the needs of each college specifically, and the culture of those colleges, who knows the culture of those colleges specifically? So I think those are two key initiatives that I want to focus on principally, before I start moving on to other things, introducing those roles to tackle those issues, to support people who are going through issues attached to those characteristics, and to just basically support those members of the ACS in their times of need.
Cool. Emerald? And again, let's speed up the questions and the answers to the questions. But yeah.
I was just going to ask about the foundation year, because I know there's like probably a lot of people don't know about it, but basically there was a foundation year started in LMH and it's like moving out into the rest of Oxford, I think next year or the year after. And the foundation year has been really good in LMH in getting more like basically ACS people in our college. Like all of the boys this year who are like in LMH are like all the black boys this year in LMH are because of the foundation year. And other than that, they probably like black boys don't really apply to LMH, and the same can be said for other colleges. So basically I wanted to ask, when the foundation year gets pushed out to all of the colleges, do you guys have any ideas for how you'd support it, or what do you think should be done to support it?
I think this would be a really good feature that could be attached to ACS Inspire. So just to reiterate, ACS Inspire is the second flagship program that I want to introduce for Access, which partners ACS with underperforming schools and reaches out to students who wouldn't otherwise get that help. I understand what it's like to be, you know, to feel, you know, underrepresented, especially in my college. I'm the only black fresher. So yeah, it's really hard. And I think a scheme like that, which provides representation, but also provides support, which will help people with their further studies, is really important. I think just communicating that to the schools through the scheme, through the roadshow, through visiting, you know, visiting the schools and telling them about Oxford, letting them know about those schemes is really important, especially in the north, as I said, and using our members to make it specific to each town and to each city in the north. And yeah, really to what those people need, because, you know, with people who don't know about these schemes, it can be really hard to apply because they think, oh, you know, Oxford isn't for me. But if you can see like an alternative route, and I actually know someone from who lives not far from me in Bradford, who's actually at LMH on the foundation there, doing PPE. But people who see that, oh, people like me have been on this scheme and they've really succeeded. V is another example. She's now at Harvard from going on the foundation year. I think that's really good. And I think the ACS could play a really important part in that through ACS Inspire.
Yeah, obviously a big thing about the ACS is adaptability. We need to be adaptable to the times, in the same light that, you know, with all the sort of, with COVID, you know, with all of that, we have to be adaptable in that sense, but we also have to be adaptable to what the changes in the university are. If, as you say, I mean, if the sort of foundation year scheme sort of moves outward towards other colleges start taking it on board, that would be a great thing. And the ACS will work accordingly, of course. I feel like whenever we're presented with challenges, we always rise to them. And I feel like we can maybe expand the committee a bit and maybe sort of do certain things in order to make it certain that everyone in the foundation year, you know, is supported, they feel supported. And at the end, hopefully, they can secure a firm place at university with our support. Because at the end of the day, that's just adding another medium to access, which we haven't really necessarily considered, because I'm pretty sure only LMH has the foundation year scheme. Correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, it has the foundation scheme, but if it comes outward and if it comes to other colleges, then sure, we can expand our committee and maybe have someone sort of targeting specifically the people who are on foundation years and sort of helping them, boosting them up, and so they can secure that eventual offer. Also, I feel like we should also mention that on the constitution, I think it sort of accommodates this as well, because people who are on foundation years at Oxford University, they are temporary members of the ACS Society. So they actually have access to our events, they have access to our welfare support, so they have access to all these things. So they will continue to be benefiting from everything that the ACS continues to put on. So not only do I think we should expand the committee, but I also feel like that we should sort of involve everybody on a foundation year more, keep them included and give them our support. So that is another medium which access can happen.
Cool. Joyce?
Hi. So I just wanted to ask about events. So I feel like over the course of the next year, events are going to be quite important with regards to the ACS, if restrictions do ease, obviously. So in light of that, what single new event are you most excited about hosting and why?
I think it's a really good question. I thought of this for a while. I swear on the presidential application, Sean was talking about leading being the next president to lead the ACS out of a pandemic. And I think to do that, you have to have a lot of strategies, both virtual to accommodate changes that might lead to a virtual setting and in-person events. One key event that I'm really excited about is one that I've created with Harvard. I've started talks with them simply because I thought connecting different ACSs within the UK is good, but you know, branching out internationally would be even better. This is something that can, you know, when I spoke about solidarity with other ACSs, ACS presidents, the Harvard BSA, through a contact I have there, through a friend, you know, they talk about things like this all the time. So I initiated conversations with them about potentially hosting something if I become president. Of course, it's not confirmed, but it'd be something that I'd really be excited to implement at Oxford.
Yeah, that's as for that, the event I'm most excited for, that's a really hard one, but I would say that it might have to be the family reunion event, because in my honest opinion, like before coming to Oxford University, of course, as I said, I was really hooked on those YouTube videos. I was watching the LMH College Tag with V and Josh sort of taking us around, you know, being really charismatic people. But then I also remember watching the Undiscovered series. I remember I saw Tony, Nana, all of these people. And I was actually excited to meet everybody at the society, you know, excited. And I feel like a lot of prospective applicants who apply, they're going to also be excited to meet people that they've seen on these YouTube videos, that they've seen in the society. But a lot of the time, they won't get to actually meet them. As you know, V's already graduated, Josh has graduated. And happily, yeah, I think it was in the Black History Month event, I actually got to hear him speak about something, some really difficult economics concept, but we won't go into that. But it's that sort of interaction that I want to have with people who have just left, alumni, because at the end of the day, it feels like these people have inspired us to join. And, you know, as Josh is trying to do his access work, I'm sure that like if he benefits them, they'll also feel like, yeah, I'd like to meet Josh Shima. I'd like to meet all these different people within the society because they're benefiting me. Look at what they're doing. They've lit a fire within me. But if you're gone and you're alumni, that's pretty much it. So I want to increase sort of this contact between current members of society and alumni. I want to make sure we all stay connected, because fundamentally, if someone's helped you out, if someone you thought was a great person who was currently within the society at the time of your application and they're just gone, that's something that we should change. And also, like, we just need to maintain that strong family vibe, because really and truly, the ACS is just a family. So yeah, that's probably the event I'm really excited for. Excited to contact them, get into contact with them. You know, it's going to be a ball as well, with food, dancing, good vibes at the end of the day, because we're all about good vibes. But yeah, I think that's the event I'm really excited for.
Chris, did you hear that? You mentioned handover ball. Tears in my eyes, man. Tears in my eyes. Cool. Three last questions. Thank you all for being so, you know, patient, etc. Morinike, sorry if I've butchered that pronunciation.
Hi, yeah, it's Morinike, but don't worry about it. Hi, everybody. Hope everybody's okay. It's been a bit heated and violent, but it's okay. Smiles all around. I'm not going to have my camera on, but I just wanted to ask, sorry if this question is a bit repetitive because my wife has been techie, but we've spoken about welfare, but I wanted to ask about from the aspect of students from home. Like, it's been very techie for students who have been at home and have been going through some difficult things. Like, COVID has taken lives really and truly, and it's been very difficult. Like, what do you plan to do to extend welfare to students at home in a way that's authentic and genuine, in a way that doesn't leave you like just having to like sit on Zoom for hours, like in a way that you can really feel like you've been understood and touched, if that makes sense?
I was speaking to one of my mentors today, just prior to this call, and he was telling me when he's doing events at work, he says that small groups always work better on Zoom, in terms of it's more interactive, it's more personal. You're not waiting with your hand up for 2 hours and no one's responding. So I think creating spaces for students like that to talk about their experiences in an intimate and personal environment is a really good way of doing so. So yeah, just, I don't know, you can have fortnightly sessions where students at home can talk about their experiences at home and how it's, you know, how it's affecting their mental health. Obviously having someone lead the call, because, you know, generally on Zoom, people say, yeah, we'll have a Zoom, You go into the Zoom, nobody's speaking, everybody's cameras off. So having someone who can lead that discussion as well would be really important for, you know, engaging these conversations. And I think a position in the committee for someone who do that, like with the welfare reps and so forth, would be a really good way of achieving that.
Yeah, thank you for asking that question, actually. It's an idea just popped into my mind. I mean, of course that, you know, it's really difficult to get into contact with our members on a really more personal level, you know, if they're at home. So I feel like in that sense, there's a lot of difficulty. But I feel like there's things that we can do as a society to sort of look out for our people at home who are sort of struggling. And it's sort of the many things that really do make a difference. For example, I feel like sending packages, you know, just sending cards to like our members when they're at home, just letting them know that like your society is here for you. We've all got you, like, don't worry about it. Like, it's all gonna be fine at the end of the day. Sending those cards, maybe sending food with it or something like that. Something in the form of the meet and eat that we had. I mean, of course, as you know, we had those, you know, members of the committee coming up to us. So it was a good, the meet and eat originally with the whole goodie bag system was a good way for us to interact with members of the committee at the beginning of the year. But I feel like now is the greatest time as any to sort of be like, okay, maybe we can sort of send something to our members at home, you know, just let them know again, once more, that we're there for them kind of thing. And I feel like that's one way in which we can sort of take into account the welfare of our members who are not currently at Oxford. So definitely that's one thing. Also, I'd like to reiterate what Josh Jim said, that was a really good idea about just having smaller Zoom sessions with people, with smaller welfare sessions, because at the end of the day, you can't really, I don't feel like you feel really comfortable opening up about, you know, things that may have been going on at home or, you know, about your concerns when you're in a large kind of space, when you're with a large number of people. So I feel like that would be another thing that we should take into account. But yeah, other than that, it's a bit hard, I feel like, to sort of completely help people when they're not at Oxford. But there's definitely things we can do, and there's definitely many things we can do to rectify that issue, for sure.
So the penultimate question from Darcy D, the bee not herself, racing us.
Hey guys, I just wanted to say, first of all, well done, because even I'm stressed out listening to you too, so well done, it's been really hard so far. I just wanted to ask a question about what you guys are gonna do to support the creative arts in Oxford, because we all know there's a massive diversity problem with the arts. And I love hearing about corporate events of Linklaters and investment banking stuff, but there's only so much that can represent for everybody in Oxford, particularly the creative students. So what are you gonna do? How are you gonna liaise with dramatic societies, music societies, and how are you gonna make students feel supported?
I really like this question, simply because I grew up as a church drummer, keyboardist. It's kind of fallen off for me, and it's something that I'd really love to get back into. So obviously when I came, a few of you in the chat will know, Liza and Marenike, I heard about the gospel choir, and I was like, really interested. But obviously with lockdown and COVID and everything, it's not come to fruition. So that's something I'd really like to revive. Not necessarily sing, because I'm not a singer, but so church drama red flags. But no, I'm not really a singer. But yeah, it's something that I'd really like to revive. I think it's a great way to connect with people remotely, but also, like, you know, promote the creative arts and stuff like that. That's really engaging, and not necessarily to do with, you know, corporate careers. Same things to do with art and all things like that. So
I'd completely agree with you. Like, it really does feel like sometimes, you know, there's so many corporate events going on, and we do really need to focus on things like, you know, the more creative arts sort of stuff there. And I feel like one way in which we can do this is through the Oxford Black Alumni Network. I remember, I think when I attended the Living History event, that was our Black History Month event, for those of you guys who didn't know, one alumni of the Oxford ACS actually came on. And I think she did work in a sort of theatre, producing music of that sort of nature. And she was actually explaining to us the kind of things that she had to do and the contacts she received through that. And like, it was really, really interesting hearing about that experience. But that is something that I've only heard about in the Black History Month event. And I feel like, you know, in essence, we need to sort of expand that, because I feel like that could have been a careers event in itself, because it was that interesting. I feel like lots of more people need to hear about that, because really and truly, I feel like if you weren't thinking about going to the Black History Month event, you would have missed out on something that good. And so definitely, I feel like liaising with the Oxford Black Alumni Network will allow us to get more people who are doing the creative arts, and even people who are doing other sorts of things as well, maybe who are into the sports scene all of that to come in and maybe give us a sort of discussion about, you know, what they kind of do, sort of make the ACS feel a bit less corporate, because I feel like in first term, especially, you can kind of feel a bit bogged down at times with all of it happening, because it's all concentrated in that term mainly because of spring week internship applications. But that's for sure. I also feel like promoting music as well, music involvement, like playing instruments is something that we should do, because I'm not going to lie to you guys, I mean, not many people know this, but I used to play trombone at my old school. Like, I don't play it now. Like, I know it's a bit like, yeah, but like, you know, I don't play it now, but I feel like, you know, we should definitely promote some instrument involvement, maybe even get like an ACS band. I mean, like, who's to say, like, what about that? An ACS band playing or something along those lines. We could play music, all of that. And like, you know, because I know for a lot of us, like, I know it's not just me. A lot of us did these creative things when we were at school, you know, whether it be playing the trombone, even like taking it out outside to like playing rugby, playing like football, all of these different things. Like, but now that we're at Oxford University, we're all about the academics, all that's it, you know, getting that job. I feel like we need to take a step back and think about, you know, the creative arts that we've developed, and we need to put that at the forefront at some stage as well. So I feel like getting an ACS band, that may be pretty good to get that too. And, you know, also, you know, getting the sort of sport events sorted. I mean, I have, I don't know if you guys checked my manifesto, but I wanted to do a sort of Oxford versus Cambridge ACS Sports Day, which I think would be really, really good. That not only increased collaboration with ACS, but, you know, we can also prove to them that, like, we're not just going to beat them university challenge, the academic stuff. We can beat them in sports stuff as well. But also, I don't know if you guys have heard, but there's an ACS Sports League, which has recently been introduced, which I think is a really, really cool idea, I'm not going to lie, where, like, lots of different ACSs, I think Manchester ACS signed up recently and Coventry ACS signed up recently. It's basically like a competition between different ACSs based on sports, different sports like basketball, football, and they have regular fixtures. So I feel like, imagine having a sort of fixture between Oxford ACS versus Coventry ACS, and then, you know, seeing all of that happen, and then all of us are being able to watch and watch our members thrive and, you know, just enjoying themselves genuinely. Because I feel like with Oxford, you can just think about, you just think about the corporate stuff all the time, and you can think, you can tend to think about your academics, and it's really kind of, it really does affect you in a sense, because you want to explore other interests. So I feel like doing these sports events, doing these music related events and creative events is something that we should definitely endeavor to do next year, and I'm all for it. I'm really, really excited, to be honest.
Yeah, no, I think that is quite an important conversation. And before the last question, I will kind of address like the whole kind of ACS too corporate. I think that's a thing that's been happening for years. And in fairness, like with Chris's committee, they were quite big on, like, you know, music, arts, expression, etc. We used to have poetry nights, an open mic night, etc. I think just with the pandemic, you know, trying to, I guess, meet the demands of like the kind of creative elements of our members has been hard. Like literally the last event we had was the ACS Gospel Choir performing on the last day. So that was insane. That was really good. But definitely, I think the future, once the pandemic's over, the future is bright for, you know, actually doing like the fun stuff and the things that matter, and, you know, embracing artistic talents, etc. And then finally, last but not least, bad man himself, Mr. Noah Wilson. Ask your question.
Noah, you're on mute. I can't hear you.
Oh, I thought that was just me, you know.
Can't hear you, bro.
Yeah, no, and yeah, you're not on mute, but we can't hear you.
Try leaving and rejoining.
Maybe Wi-Fi. For once, it's not me.
That's really embarrassing.
Now you'll be back. You'll be back. While we wait, I mean, Jackie Weaver's got nothing on this Zoom call. Tell you that much. Okay. Drop a bar in the meantime, Sean. No, we know I can't spit bars after you lot tortured me doing that last year. So
I'm stealing Esther's idea, but you need to make the two presidential candidates rap for like 20 minutes.
Maybe when Noah comes back, we'll see. Hopefully he is rejoining.
Go on, whilst we wait for Noah, you man, take your time, think of your bars, it's coming.
yeah, you lot, a quick four bar thing, a cappella, just think of it. But yeah, I'm checking the waiting room and stuff, looking for Noah. Hopefully he comes through. But yeah, obviously big up to both you, but both the presidential candidates, should I say. That was a tense Hustings, but you know, that's what Hustings are there for. Yeah, let me, he's back. Unmute yourself. Try speak. Oh, just type your question then. You're gonna have to type your question. Wow. Oh no, we can hear you now. Yeah, we can hear you now.
Oh my days. Sorry about that. So basically I just wanted to go back on what I was saying earlier in the chat about what does standing in solidarity mean, because we heard from Josh, but I didn't really hear from Aaron. And one thing I want to like remind you is that talking about writing letters, writing articles, fundraising, stuff like that, we like can all do that as people. You saw what Nadia did, you saw what Kara Ibti did over summer, you saw that kind of stuff. But you as president will have like a greater privilege and more access to ways which the society benefits the university, leverage we have over the university, because obviously we're something that's very a privilege for the university to have an ACS like us. So as president, the power you have, what will you do with that to really make standing in solidarity something tangible?
Yeah, thank you for answering that. Basically, for one thing, if I was to become president, I need to be proactive in that regard. Of course, like you said, everyone can send out emails, and more time, those emails that we send out to colleges, those statements that we release, don't even technically get addressed. So something more needs to happen if we want to change the scenario that's been going on in Oxford for countless years. So definitely, I feel like organizing these sort of, I feel like as a president, I can organize these sort of meetings with the committee and the university on a high level, where we can actually apply pressure physically, because really and truly, I don't think much is going on with the sort of situations that I've seen happen this year. Like in comparison to what was happening last year, when everything was sort of live in person, and we were hearing about all these sort of instances with the Christchurch ACS things, with the Cecile Rhodes statues and the protests that happened around that time, everyone was standing. That's what I call standing in solidarity in that instance, where everybody was there. You know, there was a proper, you know, there was a proper large gathering of people there standing for that one goal. And if there was sort of anything to happen next year with, you know, one of our members, I feel like as a president, I would need to be by their side all the way through. And rather than just sending out emails, letters, all of that, I would actually be physically trying to apply pressure to the higher power in the university, because colleges easily just dismiss this stuff. And it's like, I think we've all realized that approaching these colleges and telling them, you know, what's going on here isn't going to work, doesn't actually change much. So I feel like having that discussion with the higher powers is something that we're going to need to do more constantly, and with more people, because Effie is the only member of our committee who's actually in the Racial Equality Task Force. And if you also think about her welfare as well, having to deal with conversations with the pro vice chancellor where he's telling her, you know, we can't sort of sort this out, I'm really sorry, oh, that's really difficult too. I feel like that must be really, you know, heartbreaking for her to hear as well. So I feel like, why don't we all sort of band together and join this call and apply pressure, because genuinely, like, it's our numbers that is going to really make this change. We need to get this stuff sorted out for sure. And I feel like what you said is true. What you said is very, very true. And proactivity on my behalf is something that will need to happen there. And getting all of our committee members standing strong, all of us on there pushing through and trying to make a change at this university, because I know we can.
I think the core of your message hints at what can I do different, what's unique about the position of president that allows me to act differently to someone who's on the committee, for example. And I think the answer to that lies in my earlier point about connecting with other ACSs. I think as a president, you have a unique ability to to you, as a president, you represent the society, and in doing so, you have a unique ability to get into contact with other pressure groups and other organizations. ACSs are just one example. You could be getting into contact with charities, using them to support your your cause, in terms of, you know, tackling these issues. So as president, you have a unique characteristic, which means you represent the society in the sense that you're the basically the face of the society. And in doing so, you have unique access to these key figures who have the power to, you know, change things, who have the power to input pressure on the university, if we're talking about Oxford, to act differently. And that's what I think is standing in solidarity. I'll use an example from my own life. In terms of when I faced that racist incident, my college principal, she emailed me. I didn't ask, I didn't even tell her about anything. She just saw it on Twitter. She emailed me personally to see how I was doing. She called me on Teams. She spoke on Teams with me for around 2 hours, and she offered me free legal representation, as I said, for the issues I was facing, to attack the racism that I did face, and which was illegal. That is standing in solidarity. That's fighting against inequality and being a leader. Someone who can really resonate with the people that they are leading, and who really feel personal. I think it's different to when somebody else in the community does it, because when you're the president, you represent society. So a direct and personal approach from the president to a member of the society represents the ACS as a whole, standing for that member of society. And that's what I think standing in solidarity means to me.
Wowee. Have you got
time for a bars, some bars or?
Oh my God, I was about to end it, you know. I was actually about to end it. I forgot we you set know, these men up for bars. I forgot we set these people up for bars. All right, say less. Listen. It's got to be a cappella because the Wi-Fi, someone trying to give you a beat, it's not going to work. I see someone's asked for a beatbox, but it's not going to work. It's not going to work. Let's not forget the bars. All right, cool. who wants to go first? Eh?
Oh, wow.
Little bit. All right, do you know what? Don't even treat it like rapping. Yeah. Do like, you know, spoken word. You see how they, all the, like, I don't know, those poets do like, when with the syllables, but yeah, man, you got that, man. Do your thing, man. Alliteration, yeah, just, man.
Four bars in it. Okay.
Yeah, four bars.
My name is Josh. I am the best. Vote for me for your president. That's it. That's all I have.
Okay. We hear that one. Can't lie. Got something about the same ED. Certain man are saying, get him. Listen, I've been in your stage, innit? So let me not even. Yeah. And my thing's on Facebook for people to see. So that one there is long. Aaron.
Okay, cool. I want to try and make this a bit rhyme. I want to make it a bit rhythmical. So, all right, cool. So, I grew up in the streets. Not just joking. I went to boarding school. But we had a pool. And lots of other schools have pools too. And yeah, I'm waffling. I can't lie, I'm an A1 waffler. I can't lie. Yeah. Like that was trash. Can we rerun it? Can we rerun it?
You wanna wheel it?
Wheel it.
Say this. I can't do the sound effect. I wish I could, but here we are.
I feel like, okay, let me think about this. Okay. Coming from the heart, I've got to do my part for the ACS because it is the best. Okay, all right. This is the fam. We're going out with a bang. Aaron is signing out. Give me a shout out. Yeah. I was like, okay, no. That was all right.
Chris even came back on camera to applaud that. So there you go. No, that was good still. That was good. It's better than mine last year, I'll tell you that much. Josh, do you want to redeem yourself? Or are you calm with that 2-2 performance you that you gave?
Okay. Okay. I'm sitting on a chair. black clothes I wear, black skin on me. Hey, I'm lost. Let me start again.
Have us the best of us. Okay. Have us the best of us.
Okay. We're seeing on Zoom in a virtual room. Hey, this is hard, you know. let me think. Seeing on a Zoom in a virtual room. Looking at the camera. Near the Radcliffe camera. Everything's nice. I've got a lot of spice. I've got hot sauce. And that's the end of the Hustings. That's it. That's done. I've got nothing.
All right.
Usually I feel like it's singing time now, I'm joking.
Don't quit the day job, lads. Don't quit it. But Effie said, yeah, we're not making out the hood. Hate to see it. Extend Sean's tenure, I beg. No, listen, I need to pass it off. Man ride camera with camera. That one there, big brain energy. Sean, quick thought, you must be mad. Anyways. I think, yeah, we've got to wrap it there. We've got to wrap it there. Can I see some love in the chat for the candidates? Love in the chat, etc. Obviously, like, listen, yeah. I was there last year, and even that was tense. This, on the other hand, it exceeded my expectations. So here we are. But now you lot handled. Obviously, look. It's good to have difficult conversations at the end of the day, but let's, you know, we shouldn't never hide from difficult conversations. And you lot did really well. I think there's going to be a very, very difficult decision for all of us in our votes. But listen, I know for a fact whoever gets elected, they're going to, you know, do amazing for the society. Basically, I'm going to plug something real quick. We have a cultural conversation events coming up next week, because obviously it is quite relevant to the conversations we're having today. You know, we got people like George the Poet, Tolly T, Clara, I think I forgot her second name, but, you know, BBC radio presenter, etc. So definitely, you know, check those events out. And hopefully Iman, a North African officer, is going to do like a very special event surrounding a cult, like, you know, kind of like, you know, culture growing up in the UK, etc. So defo look out for that. In terms of voting, however, I know a lot of people are going to be wondering about voting. I don't know if Bushra is still about, where she can explain. Nah, Bushra left. Yeah, long day. That's what I expect for my committee members. But pretty much what's going to happen is that tomorrow, the voting should come out, and you have to be a member to vote. But of course, I know, like, some people might have not purchased the membership yet, or maybe, you know, because basically it's a £15 membership, which, you know, relatively is quite cheap compared to other societies. And that's when you get all the benefits, etc. So make sure you get the membership. Obviously, if you can't, like, you know, pay the £15 right now, just message me and we'll just talk about it. Because, yeah, we're not on the voter exclusion thing. £15 is a lot this far into term, not going to lie. But you bought it, though, didn't you? So I don't know why you're chatting, Amjad. But, but yeah. So we're gonna open voting on the weekend, and we'll let you know when we'll close it. Probably gonna be Sunday midnight we're gonna close it. Sean, rap for us. Listen.
Come on, like, Aaron, I think you should rap for us.
Chill out. Listen, these men don't know. I'm not gonna embarrass myself for a second time in a row. You get me?
What happens if you've improved, though? Like, don't you want to think, like, what do you think about that?
Aaron,
you can actually redeem yourself.
I mean, Sean, yeah, just do it. This is your
go for it, man. Like, we believe in you. Genuinely, we believe in you. I like Sean, you know.
Go on, Sean. I'm really.
Do you know what's mad? It's because I'm thinking about it, but I can't even get words into my head right now.
You can do the robot.
Okay, this has quickly turned into a roast Sean session. So you know what's going to happen, yeah? Well, one of my feedback from Aaron you know, stand up for yourself, say no sometimes. I'm going to say no. But obviously, thank you lot for coming through. It's been sick. You man have done amazing. And yeah, you're free to go. There we go. That ends the Hustings.